Home Auto Group Studios, Farmington Ford and Franklin Chrysler in Farmington. This is WSKW, Skowhegan, Augusta, Waterville, Legacy 1160.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so brightly we hailed but the twilight's gasping with broad stripes.
ABC News, I'm Tom Rivers. Great Britain has granted the world's first authorization for a COVID-19 vaccine.
The Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency, or MHRA, in the United Kingdom, granting temporary emergency use authorization to BioNTech and Pfizer. The vaccine will be made available there next week. The companies have also filed for emergency use authorization with the Food and Drug Administration in the U.S. and other regulatory agencies worldwide.
ABC's Lionel Moyes. An advisory panel to the Food and Drug Administration meets next week. Another advisory panel, this one to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, recommending that when there's emergency use approval of the vaccine, nursing home residents and healthcare workers will be the first to get it. Neither the White House nor the First Lady's office is commenting on a packed holiday party at the White House Tuesday night. This is ABC News. It's a massive deal involving two big names in the tech industry. Details from ABC's Alex Stone.
Many companies have come to rely on the work chatting service Slack, especially during the pandemic with employees working remotely. Now Salesforce is buying Slack for $27.7 billion. That price bigger than the GDP of most countries. It's the largest deal in the history of Salesforce. For the cloud computing company headquartered in San Francisco, it sets it up to better compete with Microsoft, offer a suite of services including chatting for employees. Slack is popular at companies as a way to chat in a more casual form than email.
Cosmetics company Sephora is setting up shop in a new store. Now plans to create a store within a store in over 800 Kohl's locations within the next 3 years. Last month, rival Ulta Beauty announced a similar deal, saying they will open up their own locations in dozens of Target stores. I'm Tom Rivers, ABC News.
Let's be real. Mopping is a hassle. You have to fill the bucket, pushing a wet, heavy mop around, then cleaning the mop when you're done so it doesn't grow bacteria. A hassle on top of a hassle. Try Swiffer WetJet. With Swiffer WetJet, you start with a fresh pad and cleaning solution every time. And when you're done, you just toss the pad. Swiffer WetJet. The faster, easier, cleaner way to clean your floors.
Finally, a bed that senses snoring and automatically responds. Introducing the new Ergo Smart Base from Tempur-Pedic. Our first system that detects snoring, then automatically adjusts by raising the bed. For a limited time, save up to $500 on adjustable mattress sets during the Tempur-Pedic Smart Sleep event. Get your best sleep. All night, every night. Learn more at Tempur-Pedic.com.
I'm CBS 13's Jeff Peterson with a news update on Legacy 1160 WSKW. Governor Janet Mills says she was likely exposed to COVID-19. In a message on Facebook, she says she's in quarantine. A member of her security detail is considered to be a probable case for the virus. Governor says she has not seen a person since last Saturday. She has no symptoms, but will continue to keep Mainers informed. Governor will take a test tomorrow and remain in quarantine through the 12th. And the Maine Republican Party is responding in a statement. They say, quote, while we hope that the governor has not contracted the virus, she owes the public and lawmakers more information. They go on to say that due to the timeline, it is possible she and her staff exposed Democratic leadership to the virus, risking spread in the state legislature. State Democrats are also responding. Senate President Troy Jackson says in a statement, quote, once again, the governor is leading by example by quarantining after a public exposure to COVID-19 and putting the health, safety, and well-being of Mainers first. Latest, the CDC numbers show 20 more Mainers have died from the coronavirus. It's important to note that some of the new deaths happened last week and the holidays delayed the most recent numbers. 219 new cases have been reported, and at last check, over 130 people remain hospitalized from the virus. CDC reporting 266 new recoveries. Maine had a record-breaking voter turnout in the November 3rd election. That's the word from Secretary of State Matt Dunlap. Nearly 78% of registered voters cast ballots in the presidential race, either by absentee ballot or in person on election day. And to top it all off, there's no record of any COVID-19 outbreak investigations associated with polling places. We have breaking news overnight about Pfizer's coronavirus vaccine. UK has become the first country to approve it for emergency use. This morning, Pfizer's CEO is responding to the news, calling the decision a, quote, historic moment. And the United States may not be far behind. The FDA is still considering Pfizer's request here. Today, the Maine State Legislature is convening for the first time since lawmakers adjourned because of the pandemic. Newly elected lawmakers will be sworn in by Acting Chief Justice Andrew Mead at the Augusta Civic Center, where the session was moved for social distancing. Right now, the CDC is planning to change some of its coronavirus guidelines. Two senior administration officials tell CNN the agency is expected to cut down quarantine recommendations from 14 days down to 7 to 10 days after exposure. And Bowdoin College and the Brunswick Hotel are working together to house students to provide each student their own room. College needs some additional housing options. Meanwhile, the hotel has seen fewer guests. According to the college, hotel will provide housing for about 25 students who cannot travel home for winter break. After the break, up to 50 first-year students will live at the hotel for the spring semester. Sports, a lot to talk about. ESPN is reporting tonight Celtics will take on Kevin Durant and Kyrie Irving and the Brooklyn Nets on Christmas night. Tip-off at 5 p.m., part of five games when it comes to the NBA. And this morning, high school students all over Maine will get a chance to take part in a virtual symposium being presented by the Maine Sports Hall of Fame. Nesson's Tom Karen will be the moderator. Of course, Tom used to work at CBS 13 as well. At 9 a.m., students will hear from Celtics VP and player development Allison Feaster, along with Red Claws president Dwan Eubanks. At 10 a.m., former University of Maine, Michigan State, and Duke women's basketball coach Joanne Palama-McCallie will be joined by her former player and current UMaine women's basketball coach Amy Vachon. And then at 11 a.m., this year's Division III NCAA Women's Basketball Player of the Year, former Bowdoin grade Maddie Hassett, will join former UMaine football star and longtime NFL lineman Mike DeVito. I'm CBS 13's Jeff Peterson on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
If you've checked that gift list twice and it's got something different for everyone on it, just head to Town Line Antique Center on the Winslow-Vassalboro Town Line. With two floors and over 50 dealers, you can find the perfect gift for each one of them. Are you worried about spending too much? Well, don't. Town Line Antiques is here to help you with that, too. Because all December long, every booth at Town Line Antiques is offering discounts of 10, 20, 30, 40, and yes, even 50% off their selection. There's always new, cool, and unique gift ideas, including things like collectibles, furniture, artwork, signs, books, and so much more. Of course, the problem is you'll not only find lots of great gift ideas, you'll come across things that you may want to take home too. But with their December sale of up to 50% off store wide, you can take them home, all of them, for less. So don't miss out on this Santa size sale with savings of up to 50% off this December at Town Line Antiques, open Tuesday through Sunday from 10 to 5 on Route 201, right on the Winslow-Vassalboro Town Line.
At Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union, they understand that when faced with difficult and challenging times, it's a comfort to know that we'll get through this together. Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union is committed to keeping not only their members safe, but also their dedicated employees. They are following CDC guidelines, protocols, and social distancing at all of their facilities. They may have changed some of their usual ways of doing business, but they haven't changed how they treat their members. Their safest services are available through drive-up, ATM, telephone, easy banking, mobile banking, by phone, or appointment. Lobbies are currently open in the Skowhegan and Farmington branches, and with the holidays just around the corner, Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union has a reason to brighten your season with their holiday loan special going on now through December 31st. Just ask any of their friendly and knowledgeable loan officers in Skowhegan, Farmington, Madison, Kingfield, or Stratton for complete details, or online at f-sfcu.com. Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union, where their most important member is you. Member NCUA.
I'm CBS 13 meteorologist Lexi O'Connor. Mostly sunny this morning, but we'll see increasing clouds through this afternoon. Chance for a snow shower late afternoon and evening, especially through New Hampshire and the hills and mountains. We'll be more seasonal with highs in the low 40s today. Mostly sunny, highs in the mid 40s tomorrow. Clouds return on Friday, and we'll have the chance for some rain and mountain snow Saturday and into Sunday.
Thank you, Lexi. Clear skies. We've got 36 in Skowhegan, 37 in Waterville. Clear skies, 37 as well in Augusta. And you're up to date from Maine's Heritage Station, Legacy 1160, WSKW.
You think it? He says it.
Yada, yada, yada.
It's the Mike Violet Show on Legacy 1160, WSKW.
Good morning. Welcome in. It's that middle of the weekday that we affectionately refer to around here as Wednesday. 6/12, Wednesday, December 2nd, 2020. I am Mike Violet. Welcome in. Glad to have you with me on the Mike Violet Show. It's brought to you by Kennebec Electric and Lighting. Contact them for all your electric and lighting servicing, including, but not limited to, expert installations and repairs, 861-7028, online at kennebecelectric.com. Live stream us 24-7, 365, anywhere in the big bad world. Go to legacy1160.com. It's sponsored by the Harry J. Smith Company. And we're on Facebook Live, too, on the Legacy page, my page, John James page, John's Freedom Pep Rally page, and John and that Freedom Pep Rally will be here live on the radio and our live stream coming up at 9 this morning, all part of 6 hours of live local talk. Also, the Facebook feed available on John's American Women Who Bear Arms page, brought to you by Moody's Collision Center. Almost the typical Wednesday today. Ken Alt, Julie here, the Ken and Mike Hour, next hour. From 7 until 8 o'clock. Agree to Disagree is here. The combatants, though, are different. On one side, in one corner, Phil Harriman. And again, Phil may have to use his whole brain today because on the other side, pinch hitting for Ethan Strimling is Betsy Sweet. So we'll get the female perspective. We have a chick on the show opposite Phil today. Agree to Disagree coming up with Betsy Sweet and Phil Harriman. That's on the way at 8:08. Let's get cracking, though. You know the drill.
Hashtag what? They didn't really say that, did they?
Even while I was on vacation, I woke up in the middle of the night at 3:30 in the morning, just concerned about climate change.
It's hashtags and hot takes on the Mike Violet Show on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
All righty, and I'm not, let's rewind that tape. All righty, item number one this morning, General Mills, Governor Mills, making the announcement yesterday that she might have been exposed to the Rona. She made the announcement yesterday at the Blaine House.
And no one is immune from exposure to someone with the virus or from the infection itself or from the impacts on our work and daily lives. And I'm no exception. Today, my routine is changing. I've been informed that a member of my security detail is considered to be a probable case of COVID-19. So while I have not seen this individual since last Saturday, while we always wore masks and kept distances, I'm still taking the same steps that other Maine people have taken to keep others safe, quarantining and getting a test.
It may be the Republicans' dream. Governor Mills in quarantine for the next 14 days. The governor did say she felt fine. She's not experiencing
any symptoms, but as we have said all along, no one is immune from exposure to the virus. She posted a 2.5-minute video on Facebook yesterday. And of course, as the governor said, a member of her Maine State Police Security Detail, known as the EPU, the Executive Protection Unit, is presumed to be positive for the virus. That member developed the symptoms Monday and is awaiting the results of a test. So this meant, of course, or this means, of course, that the governor was supposed to go to the Civic Center this morning and swear in the next state legislature during the socially distant proceedings that are going to go on there today. That duty is now going to fall on the lap of Andrew Mead, who's the acting Chief Justice of the Maine Supreme Court since Lee Softly left earlier this year. So it's going to be a weird day over there for sure. First of all, it's going to be at the Civic Center. It's going to be all spread out, going to be done in very small groups. And it's not going to be done by Governor Mills. Again, Andrew Mead is going to do the swearing in. Senate President Troy Jackson said throughout this pandemic, Governor Mills has acted quickly and decisively, and her steadfast leadership has put us in a better position than most, said the rump-swabbing Jackson. Once again, the governor is leading by example by quarantining after a possible exposure that is to COVID-19, and putting the health, the safety, and the well-being, blah, 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 blah. All right, let's move on from that. Excuse me. There. COVID relief. Maine Senators Susan Collins and Angus King joining a bipartisan group of Senate colleagues yesterday to propose roughly $900 billion in a coronavirus relief package to states, businesses, and unemployed Americans. The bipartisan proposal seeks to pressure congressional leaders as well as the White House to end the months-long stalemate as the nationwide economy struggles and COVID-19 infections, hospitalizations, and deaths go up. Existing programs are set to expire or run dry by the end of the month, so Congress, as usual, waits right until the end to find some common ground. So this is the deal here. 9 senators, 4 Democrats, 4 Republicans, and King, an independent, the story says. That's 5 Democrats and 4 Republicans, includes $180 billion to provide $300 a week in federal unemployment insurance, that is, for an additional 4 months. That plan would also provide $288 and assistance to small business, including $228 billion in forgivable loans through the PPP program and $160 billion for state, local, and tribal governments. If you're looking for another $1,200 check, it's not in this proposal. And these are all great things. Don't get me wrong here. And I'm not advocating necessarily for the $1,200 check, although it's nice. But I worry that a lot of this stuff is going to get used and abused, much like the first round did. And wouldn't it be better to make a direct payment to Mr. and Mrs. American? Just a direct payment. That's it. Nothing else. I'm just saying. Because these government programs, these grants, these payroll protection things, they all sound good and look good, but are they really good in the end? Joe Biden says, don't worry, help is on the way. The man who the mainstream media says won the election introduced top advisors that he says will help his administration rebuild an economy hammered by the COVID.
A team that's tested and experienced. It includes groundbreaking Americans who come from different backgrounds, but who share my core vision for economic relief here in the United States of America.
He almost got thrown off by the teleprompter there. That's Biden yesterday in Wilmington, Delaware, as he arrived at the Queen Theater, or he got to the Queen. I'm reading the caption of a photograph here that has a picture of Biden in his walking boot, because, of course, he fractured his leg. Let's rewind the tape, because he, quote, fractured his leg or foot, unquote, playing with his dog. He did point to his boot and lifted his leg, it says here, to briefly show it off. And then it says the injury, while not serious, again intensifies scrutiny on Biden's age, given that he just turned 78 years old and is the oldest president ever in his first term. We'll see how much more the media concentrates on that, not from the perspective of a fractured foot, but a fractured brain. So Janet Yellen getting a lot of publicity to being, because she is, that is, because she's going to be, that is, the first female Secretary of the Treasury. She also spoke yesterday.
It's a convergence of tragedies that is not only economically unsustainable, but one that betrays our commitment to giving every American an equal chance to get ahead.
You're the Secretary of the Treasury. Can you hear a little social justice warrioring there? Yeah, I think you can. We'll hear more from Madam Secretary of the Treasury nominee coming up later on. Bill Barr says, hey, there's no shenanigans going here. Disputing President Trump, the Attorney General says the Justice Department has found no widespread election fraud. Rudy Giuliani had a nice comeback to that yesterday. America's mayor said, with all due respect to the Attorney General, there hasn't been any semblance of an investigation into the president's complaints. And he's probably right there. Senator Chuck U. Schumer quipped, I guess Barr's going to be the next one to be fired. Well, he hasn't been fired as of yet, but Rudy's statement should be taken to heart. I don't think Bill Barr has exactly busted his hind end trying to find any election irregularities. We'll talk to both Ken Altshuler and Betsy Sweet and Phil Harriman. That's three people coming up later on this morning. Ken at 7:08, Betsy and Phil at 8:08. Betsy in for Ethan this morning. Let's go to the People's Republic of Portland, where the Portland Regional Chamber of Commerce is asking a judge to rule that a voter-approved measure to require a minimum wage of $18 an hour for Portland workers during declared emergencies, hazard pay, violates both the Maine Constitution and city ordinances. The lawsuit was filed yesterday, and it would seek to short-circuit the hazard pay provision in a broader citizen initiative to raise the city's minimum wage. It passed by more than 60% on November 3rd. Now, chamber officials set a provision in a measure that increases the city's minimum wage by an additional 50% for people who report to Portland workplaces during declared emergencies is not sustainable and not legal. And while certainly philosophically I agree with the Portland Chamber of Commerce, the will of the people is the will of the people. And aren't you almost at a point with me? Maybe you are, maybe you aren't, maybe it's just me, it usually is, where it's time for the people of Portland to suffer the consequences of their voting actions and make it really hurt. And again, I have sympathy for all of the businesses involved here. And actually, this suit was filed on behalf of two Portland restaurants, Nosh and Slab. Of course, Matt Moran, former guest on this program, the owner of both of those. The Gritty McDuff's Brew Pub, Play It Again Sports, the Alliance for Addiction and Mental Health Services as well. But isn't it time for the citizens of Portland literally to suffer the consequences, the unintended consequences, the intended consequences, whatever, of their votes? And maybe if they do, maybe they'll stop voting like they do. And so these nitwit referendums don't pass. Okay, how about that Secretary of State's race? It was a brouhaha, a Donnybrook. And who was the last woman standing? Soon-to-be former Senator Shenna Bellows is going to be the next Secretary of State. She, of course, would be and will be the first woman to hold the post if the legislature approves her today, and they certainly will. The Democrats also nominated Aaron Fry again, that is, to be the AG, and Henry Beck for the treasurer. So the 100 Democrats used rank choice voting to decide from the five candidates, and Bellows advanced after four rounds of voting. Let's see if I can remember who she beats. Justin Chenette, Matt Moonen, Craig Hickman, Eric Jorgensen, and Tom Bull. There will be no Bull as the Secretary of State. So Shenna Bellows, a surprising choice, I think, to be the Secretary of State. And, you know, maybe the best of a bad lot. She might be the world's tallest midget here at the end of the day. And at the end of the day, Matt Dunlap will be unopposed to be the state auditor. He's not qualified, but he'll be unopposed because that's the way the Democrats do business in the Maine state legislature. And frankly, the Republicans do too with these Sakurama jobs. And that, friends, is Hashtags and Hot Takes for this morning. It's that middle of the weekday that we call Wednesday. It is December 2nd, 2020. We do this every Monday through Friday without fail, right after the 6 o'clock news.
Focus on the White House. Attorney General William Barr spent 2.5 hours at the Executive Mansion Tuesday. Earlier, he told the Associated Press there's no evidence of widespread election fraud.
He specifically shot down one of the president's most explosive claims, that voting machines were manipulated to help Joe Biden win, saying simply, "We haven't seen anything to substantiate that." This is especially significant because Barr has been among the president's most steadfast defenders.
ABC's Jonathan Carl. With the last pandemic relief measures expiring at the end of the month, a bipartisan group of senators is pushing a $900 billion proposal. Majority Leader Mitch McConnell countered with a $500 billion measure, similar to the one that failed earlier.
The reality is that the two sides still remain far apart on the details. This compromise bill, for instance, would not include another round of stimulus checks.
ABC's Mary Bruce, this against a government shutdown set for next week Friday. Richard Cantu, ABC News.
If you've checked the gift list twice and it's got something different for everyone on it, just head to Town Line Antique Center on the Winslow Vassalboro Town Line. With two floors and over 50 dealers, you can find the perfect gift for each one of them. Are you worried about spending too much? Townline Antiques is here to help you with that too. Because all December long, every booth at Townline Antiques is offering discounts of 10, 20, 30, 40, some even 50% off their selection. There's always new, cool, and unique gift ideas, including collectibles, furniture, artwork, signs, books, and much more. Of course, the problem is, you not only find lots of great gift ideas, you'll come across things that you may want to take home for yourself. But with their December sale of up to 50% off, you can take them all home for less. So don't miss out on this Santa-sized sale with savings up to 50% off this December. At Townline Antiques, open Tuesday through Sunday from 10 to 5. Route 201, right on the Winslow Vassalboro Town Line.
Interested in cutting your fuel oil bills by as much as 40%? Then call your Energy Kinetic System 2000 premier dealer, Pools Plumbing, Heating, and Air Conditioning, and ask about the System 2000. You can save up to 40% off your heating cost and have all the hot water you need with the System 2000 from Energy Kinetics. Whether you're planning on replacing your current boiler or building a new home, stop into the Pools showroom at 19 North Street in Waterville and see the System 2000 from Energy Kinetics. The System 2000 runs on oil or propane, can be converted between fuels with a simple burner change, is whisper quiet, and can save you up to 40% off your heating fuel cost. If you own an older boiler, help keep it running more efficiently with a cleaning and tune-up. And don't forget, when you need emergency service, call Houle's 24-hour service department at 872-6762. Houle's Plumbing, Heating, and Air Conditioning, your System 2000 premier dealer.
The end of the year is bringing with it big savings on new vehicles during the Big Finish sales event going on now at Hike Chrysler Dodge Jeep. Stop in and save now through December 31st. Hike Chrysler Dodge Jeep, 507 Lakewood Road, Clow's Corner, Madison.
I'm CBS 13's Jeff Peterson with a news update on Legacy 1160 WSKW. Governor Janet Mills says she was likely exposed to COVID-19. In a message on Facebook, she says she's in quarantine. A member of her security detail is considered to be a probable case for the virus. Governor says she has not seen a person since last Saturday. She has no symptoms, but will continue to keep Mainers informed. Governor will take a test tomorrow and remain in quarantine through the 12th. And the Maine Republican Party is responding in a statement. They say, quote, "While we hope that the governor has not contracted the virus, she owes the public and lawmakers more information." They go on to say that due to the timeline, it is possible she and her staff exposed Democratic leadership to the virus, risking spread in the state legislature. State Democrats are also responding. Senate President Troy Jackson says in a statement, quote, Once again, the governor is leading by example by quarantining after a public exposure to COVID-19 and putting the health, safety, and well-being of Mainers first. Latest, the CDC numbers show 20 more Mainers have died from the coronavirus. It's important to note that some of the new deaths happened last week and the holidays delayed the most recent numbers. 219 new cases have been reported, and at last check, over 130 people remain hospitalized from the virus. CDC reporting 266 new recoveries. Maine had a record-breaking voter turnout in the November 3rd election. That's the word from Secretary of State Matt Dunlap. Nearly 78% of registered voters cast ballots in the presidential race, either by absentee ballot or in person on election day. And to top it all off, there's no record of any COVID-19 outbreak investigations associated with polling places. We have breaking news overnight about Pfizer's coronavirus vaccine. UK has become the first country to approve it for emergency use. This morning, Pfizer's CEO is responding to the news, calling the decision a, quote, historic moment. And the United States may not be far behind. The FDA is still considering Pfizer's request here. Today, the Maine State Legislature is convening for the first time since lawmakers adjourned because of the pandemic. Newly elected lawmakers will be sworn in by Acting Chief Justice Andrew Mead at the Augusta Civic Center, where the session was moved for social distancing. Right now, the CDC is planning to change some of its coronavirus guidelines. Two senior administration officials tell CNN the agency is expected to cut down quarantine recommendations from 14 days down to 7 to 10 days after exposure. And Bowdoin College and the Brunswick Hotel are working together to house students to provide each student their own room. College needs some additional housing options. Meanwhile, the hotel has seen fewer guests. According to the college, hotel will provide housing for about 25 students who cannot travel home for winter break. After the break, up to 50 first-year students will live at the hotel for the spring semester. Sports, a lot to talk about. ESPN is reporting tonight Celtics will take on Kevin Durant and Kyrie Irving and the Brooklyn Nets on Christmas night. Tip-off at 5 p.m., part of five games when it comes to the NBA. And this morning, high school students all over Maine will get a chance to take part in a virtual symposium being presented by the Maine Sports Hall of Fame. Nesson's Tom Karen will be the moderator. Of course, Tom used to work at CBS 13 as well. At 9 a.m., students will hear from Celtics VP and player development Allison Feaster, along with Red Claws President Dewan Eubanks. At 10 a.m., former University of Maine, Michigan State, and Duke women's basketball coach Joanne Palama-McCallie will be joined by her former player and current UMaine women's basketball coach Amy Vachon. And then at 11 a.m., this year's Division III NCAA Women's Basketball Player of the Year, former Bowdoin grade Maddie Hassett, will join former UMaine football star and longtime NFL lineman Mike DeVito. I'm CBS 13's Jeff Peterson on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
If you've checked that gift list twice and it's got something different for everyone on it, just head to Townline Antique Center on the Winslow-Vassalboro Town Line. With two floors and over 50 dealers, you can find the perfect gift for each one of them. Wait, are you worried about spending too much? Townline Antiques is here to help with that too, because all December long, every booth at Townline Antiques is offering discounts of 10, 20, 30, 40, some are even 50% off their entire selection. And there's always new, cool, and unique gift ideas, including collectibles, furniture, artwork, signs, books, and so much more. Of course, the problem is, I not only find lots of great gift ideas, I always come across things I want too. But with their December sale of up to 50% off store-wide, we can take them all home for less. So don't miss out on this Santa-sized sale with savings of up to 50% off this December at Townline Antique Center. Open Tuesday through Sunday from 10 to 5. Route 201, right on the Winslow-Vassalboro Town Line.
At Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union, they understand that when faced with difficult and challenging times, it's a comfort to know that we'll get through this together. Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union is committed to keeping not only their members safe, but also their dedicated employees. They're following CDC guidelines, protocols, and social distancing at all of their facilities. They may have changed some of their usual ways of doing business, but they haven't changed how they treat their members. Their safest services are available through drive-up, ATM, telephone, easy banking, mobile banking, by phone, or appointment. Lobbies are currently open in the Skowhegan and Farmington branches, and with the holidays just around the corner, Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union has a reason to brighten your season with their holiday loan special going on now through December 31st. Just ask any of their friendly and knowledgeable loan officers in Skowhegan, Farmington, Madison, Kingfield, or Stratton for complete details, or online at f-sfcu.com. Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union, where their most important member is you. Member NCUA.
I'm CBS 13 meteorologist Lexi O'Connor. Mostly sunny this morning, but we'll see increasing clouds through this afternoon. Chance for a snow shower late afternoon and evening, especially through New Hampshire and the hills and
Rolling Mountains. We'll be more seasonal with highs in the low 40s today. Mostly sunny, highs in the mid-40s. Tomorrow, clouds return on Friday, and we'll have the chance for some rain and mountain snow Saturday and into Sunday.
Thank you, Lexi. Clear, 36 in Skowhegan, 38 in Waterville. Clear skies, 37 degrees in Augusta. That's the deal. You're up to date. Remains Heritage Station, Legacy 1160 WSKW.
His mediocre high school academic achievements have prepared him nicely for a career in radio.
Fat, drunk, and stupid is no way to go through life, son.
It's the Mike Violet Show on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
Good morning, I'm Mike Violet. Who else would I be? It's 6:35. It's the Mike Violet Show. It's brought to you by Kennebec Electric and Lighting, 861-7028, online, kennebecelectric.com. Live stream us 24-7, 365, anywhere in this big, bad world. Go to legacy1160.com. That's brought to you by the Harry J. Smith Company. And on Facebook Live as well, thanks to Moody's Collision Center. It's that middle of the weekday that we refer to as Wednesday. No humps around here. Ken's here. Next hour, Ken being my once and now current partner, Ken Altshuler. 808, agree to disagree. The boys are back, except it's not the boys today. It's a boy and a girl. It's Phil Harriman, and pinch hitting for Ethan Strimling is the girl, Betsy Sweets, who, of course, ran for Senate. She's run for governor. She is, I guess you'd call her, I don't know, an activist, a lobbyist, and a very good political commentator as well. I know Ken's worked with her on Woke Center Maine's political brew before. So, Betsy, in for Phil. So Phil may have to use his entire brain matter today. Of course, you know, he can go, you know, half-assed against Ethan. That's easy. But today he may have to go full tilt. Okay. Sound segments this morning. First of all, Joe Biden says yesterday, the man who the mainstream media says won the election, says, don't worry, help is on the way, including the new Treasury Secretary, Janet Yellen. Let's listen to some of what the Treasury Secretary nominee had to say. That's the Treasury Secretary.
Inaction will produce a self-reinforcing downturn, causing yet more devastation. And we risk missing the obligation to address deeper structural problems, inequality, stagnant wages, especially for workers who lack a college education. Communities that have seen industry disappear with no good jobs replacing lost ones. Racial disparities in pay, job opportunities, housing, food security, and small business lending that deny wealth building to communities of color. Gender disparities that keep women out of the workforce and keep our economy from running at full force. It's a convergence of tragedies that is not only economically unsustainable, but one that betrays our commitment to giving every American an equal chance to get ahead. But I know this team will never give up that commitment. As you've said before, Mr. President-elect, out of our collective pain as a nation, we will find collective purpose to control the pandemic and build our economy back better than before, to rebuild our infrastructure and create better jobs, to invest in our workforce, to advance racial equity and make sure the economic recovery includes everyone, to address the climate crisis with American ingenuity and American jobs, working together with the outstanding national security and foreign policy team you announced last week to help restore America's global leadership. And above all...
Okay, that's Janet Yellen. Racial inequality? She's the Treasury Secretary nominee. Gender disparities? She's the Treasury Secretary nominee. The climate crisis? She's the Treasury Secretary nominee. Now, I don't know specifically what the Treasury Secretary's job description is. I didn't know, though,
that racial inequality, gender disparities, and the climate crisis were part of it. That's just me. Usually it is. Okay. Ah, but wait, there's more. You knew, you know, it's expected reliable behavior that the man, the mainstream media says, won the election, was going to have an administration full of social justice warriors doing social justice warrioring stuff. So Joe Biden has a plan to give transgender students in federally funded schools access to sports, access to bathrooms, and access to locker rooms in accordance with their gender identity. And Chuck Schumer, well, Mr. Man, he's on board.
Last one.
Joe Biden said that on his first day of office, he will give transgender students access to sports, bathrooms, and locker rooms in accordance with their gender identity in all federally funded schools. Do you think he has the ability to do this, and do you agree with this decision?
I agree with the decision, and I know he'll check things out thoroughly legally.
So this is what's going to happen. Social justice warrioring. There wasn't anything from Janet Yellen about making the economy roar like it did a year ago at this time, or anything like that. We got Joe Biden talking about athletes with penises running races against girls who don't have penises and having the DNA makeup of a person with a penis, i.e. a man, and that's going to be okay. Bathrooms, yep. Long as you identify as with that gender, you're in like Flynn, baby, or Flynette, whatever the case may be. All right. Lastly, one of my favorite people on YouTube and social media is JP Sears. Tremendously funny and insightful comedian and observer of the stupidest times ever. Here with a bit talking about the elitists who control you and me. Whoops, you can't hear that, can you? That's because I didn't do that. All right, let's go back to the beginning. Try it again. About the elitists who control you and me.
Whoever controls the media controls the population. And that's us. We're the elite. We control the media. And therefore, we control you. I can assure you, we the elite are not motivated by money. Even though there's just a few of us and we own nearly all of it, we're not motivated by money. We wouldn't stoop to that level. Money's a poor man's currency. We're motivated by control, specifically by controlling people. If you thought it was a thrill to make a bunch of money, just wait until you have control over a bunch of actual people. It's way more thrilling. Like, you know how you love your family and how you do anything for them? Yeah, well, that's how we feel about control. We love it. And we just want control over everyone and everything. Think about it this way. Have you ever been in a relationship with a really controlling person? You know how awful that can feel? So you can imagine how much better it feels to be the person who's doing the controlling in the relationship. So that's what we're trying to do in our relationship with everybody. We love being in control. Feels so good to us. That's why we make up rules to protect people. They clearly don't, because they're not designed to protect people. They're engineered to give us control over people. Like a 10 p.m. curfew? Think about that. I can assure you that one's not because COVID's nocturnal. Do you know what the feeling's like knowing everyone's putting on a mask to cover their identity just to go into a store? And we're not even there, but they're doing it anyway. That's how much control we have over them. It's intoxicating. Some say it's kind of like playing God, but not true. It is playing God. In fact, it's actually more than playing God, because God doesn't control people. He gives them free will. We do control people. So I wonder if we could control God. Jerry, see if we can get God to go into quarantine. How do we control you? With fear. It's actually the only way we can control you. Are the masses of people scared of the virus or what the virus has done? No, even though they think they are. They're scared of what we've told them the virus is, what it has done, and what it will do. Essentially, we want to keep you scared 24/7, even while you sleep. So again, why do we want you scared? So we can control you, because we love control, not you. Getting people to willingly do things is controlling. It's great, but getting people to do things that are against their will is the G-spot of control. It's exponentially more controlling. Then you're at a level of control where people are like, I want to have friends over, but I won't because I'm not supposed to. They're going against their own will. Or they're like, I don't want to wear a mask. They don't do anything. But I'll put one on to go into the store so no one gets angry at me. They're doing what they themselves don't want to do. And we're doing it to them. You know, getting people to get injected with something is controlling. It's good. I'm not saying it's not. It's controlling. But getting people to get injected with something that they don't want to get injected with is so much more controlling. And that's what we're kind of doing here. Is this making sense to you? Picking up what I'm putting down? We also strengthen the venom of control circulating in people by getting them to do what they know is harmful to them. Like we tell people, sunlight kills the virus, so stay inside. And when they submit to that, even though they know what they're submitting to doesn't make any sense and is harmful to them, they're betraying themselves and becoming more loyal to us, which means we have more control over them than they do. And that's a win. And in the same vein, we also like to tell people, if you're overweight, you're at high risk. So we're going to close down all the gyms for your protection. And then they don't exercise. And the ace up our sleeve that people fall for all the time is we actually tell them human connection is bad for them. It's like telling a fish that water's bad for them. But the difference between fish and people is people will fall for it. So it's good. Another strategy that helps volumize the amount of control we have over people is we prey on the most scared people to get them to police the unscared people. Like, have you ever seen someone yelling at someone else for not wearing a mask? Or someone calling the authorities on a business that didn't shut down? Or someone reporting their neighbors because they had friends over? We're controlling them to control you. It's control squared. And I think it was Einstein who had the breakthrough equation, E equals MC squared. The C stands for controlled. The M is for masses, and the E is for elite. Elite equals masses controlled squared. Simple math. Now there's three things we must control in order to have complete control over you. Your thoughts, your words, and your actions. Controlling your actions. We're doing that. Wear a mask, shut your business down, stay in your home, stay 6 feet apart, etc. Controlling your words. Yeah, we're doing that. It's called censorship. We censor speech that speaks out against the scare tactics that we're using to control people. A nice side effect of this one is it's much easier to control people who don't know they're being controlled. That's why we don't let people talk about what we're doing when they recognize what we're doing. And controlling your thoughts. Yeah, we're doing that too. We control the media to control your thinking. Whoever controls the media controls the population. And that's us. We're the elite. We control the media, and therefore we control you. Controlling the media is how we censor your thinking, and therefore it's how we control your thinking. Because controlling your thinking shouldn't be left up to you. It should be left up to us, as we need to control your thoughts, words, and actions in order to have complete control over you. Because we love control. Will a heroin addict ever feel like they have enough heroin? Probably not. Will we ever feel like we have enough control over you? Probably not. So we'll gladly continue taking more control if you keep letting us. Stop what you're doing and be grateful with me. Specifically, I want to share my gratitude for the sponsor of this video, Drink Element.
All right.
Now, you probably already know that Drink
Element. JP Sears reinforcing my line that we are living in the stupidest times ever. We really are. Think about what you just heard. We literally have allowed an election to be decided, taking the fraud activity out of the entire equation. We literally have allowed an election to decide, or we've allowed the fear factor and the fear tactics to decide an election. I'll get it out eventually. 651, don't submit. I'm Mike Violet. This is the Mike Violet Show on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
ABC Entertainment News.
Comedy, commentary, and squirrels top YouTube's list of top trending videos for 2020.
Thank you all for coming.
Coming in first was Dave Chappelle's poignant 846.
This man kneeled on a man's neck.
In which he took to the stage not so much for comedy, but to get real about the death of George Floyd and the protests that followed. Mark Rober's squirrel obstacle course came in second.
So the first challenge is the bridge of instability.
With Saturday Night Live's presidential debate spoof in third.
Boring.
Stranger Things star Millie Bobby Brown in tears over an encounter with a fan who took video of her shopping after the actress asked her not to.
And I said, no, when I said no. It just makes me upset when people try to push the boundary.
She posted that on Instagram. The Crown star Helena Bonham Carter says she agrees the show should have a warning label telling viewers it's not entirely accurate. And oops, she did it again. Britney Spears is 39 today. Jason Athenson, ABC News. Hollywood.
Hi, I'm CJ McKenna, Assistant Dean Enrollment at Kennebec Valley Community College. Have you been thinking about attending KVCC and need a little nudge? In my position at the college, I have the opportunity to help students begin, continue, or complete a degree. These students are just like you, many balancing multiple responsibilities in addition to their classes. Whether you want to enroll full-time, part-time, or have a conversation about your options, I am here to help. Call me at 453-KVCC and we can work together to accomplish your educational goals.
If you've checked that gift list twice and got something different for everyone on it, just head to Townline Antique Center on the Winslow-Vassalboro Town Line. With two floors and over 50 dealers, you can find the perfect gift for each one of them. Are you worried about spending too much? Townline Antiques is here to help with that too. Because all December long, every booth at Townline Antiques is offering discounts of 10, 20, 30, 40, some even 50% off their selection. There's always new, cool, and unique gift ideas, including collectibles, furniture, artwork, signs, books, and so much more. Of course, the problem is, you'll not only find lots of great gift ideas, you'll come across things you may want to take home too. But with their December sale of up to 50% off store-wide, you can take them all home for less. So don't miss out on this Santa-sized sale with savings up to 50% off this December at Townline Antiques. Open Tuesday through Sunday from 10 to 5, Route 201, right on the Winslow-Vassalboro Town Line.
Hi, my name is Tony Esposito from Rockland Ford. This year has been crazy. And this month, so are our deals. Ford has finally started making cars again, so our lot is full and the incentives are high. This month only, you can buy a brand new redesigned Ford Escape for as low as $22,415 or $359 a month with no money down. I repeat, you can buy a brand new Ford Escape at Rockland Ford for as low as $359 a month with no money down. And if a truck is what you need, we got you covered. Rockland Ford just made a special purchase of 35 low-mileage program F-150s, as low as $23,995 or only $359 a month with no money down. This month only, buy a brand new Escape or program F-150 for $359 a month with no money down. Call us while supplies last at Rockland Ford, home of the Rock Bottom Deal, Route 1 in Thomaston.
Payments for qualified credit for 84 months at 4.5% APR.
Sales and service by a family who cares. Widmore & Sons, Widmore & Sons.
There are some things you can simply never depend on, like getting your office printer to work on the first try.
another paper jam? Come on. But know that you can always count on Whittemore & Sons in our line of Coyote tractors. Coyote tractors are machines made to work, whether it's mowing, tilling, digging, lifting, or hauling. Check out the full line of tough and versatile Coyote tractors, attachments, implements, and accessories at Whittemore & Sons, your Coyote tractor dealer, with dependable sales and service for over 50 years. Run ahead of the pack with a Coyote tractor from Whittemore & Sons on the Waterville Road in Skowhegan. Sales and service by a family who cares.
From work to fun, we'll help you get it done. Whittemore & Sons. Outdoor power equipment.
Hi, it's Doug and Dan from Generators of Maine in Belgrade.
Are you working from home? Will your children be home doing schoolwork? And you know how important it is to have access to the reliable power source.
That's why you need a Kohler generator from Generators of Maine. Kohler generators deliver reliable power whenever yours goes out. And we're always happy to offer delivery and installation.
Get prepared today for those upcoming power outages with a Kohler generator from Generators of Maine. Stop by our location in Belgrade, visit online at generatorsofmaine.com, and like us on Facebook.
6:56, that middle of the weekday that we call Wednesday. It's Wednesday, December 2nd, 2020. Mike Violet here on the Mike Violet Show. A couple of things that I didn't have time for during hashtags and hot takes this morning. Aside from Governor Mills being in quarantine because she might have been exposed to someone who's got the Rona, the governor unveiled a four-year climate action plan yesterday, making a plea for urgent action. The governor's plan draws the attention of President-elect Biden's climate envoy. You know him, you love him. He's the former French-looking senator from Massachusetts, John Kerry, who said that Maine could set an example for the nation if the state follows the plan. And you've heard this all before. Clean energy jobs. Governor Mills says 30,000 of them by 2030. 30,000 clean energy jobs, says the advocate for the corridor. And also, she says, further advancing cost-effective renewable energy development. Is there any such thing as renewable energy development? And she's also going to work with lawmakers on a bond package that would promote economic recovery from the coronavirus. But the governor said climate change is going to have profound implications for our state, our economy, our people, both present and future. This is why Maine won't wait and can't wait to take action. So whether it is social justice warrioring of some kind or climate changing of some kind, this is what we're going to get. At the national level, if the man who the mainstream media says won the election actually won the election, and as we move on now with the legislative makeup and Governor Mills here in Augusta, it isn't going to be pretty. We're going to hear a lot more about this kind of stuff. What I say is drama queen, wishful thinking kind of stuff from the left on their precious renewable non-fossil fuel energy. Speaking of lefties, Ken Altshuler is going to join the show. It's the Ken and Mike Hour. That is coming up next. First, though, a world and national news update from ABC News, world and national news. Then, a Maine and local news update, real news from CBS 13's Jeff Peterson. Lexi's got the forecast. The Mike Violet Show rolls on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
From the Home Auto Group Studios, Farmington Ford and Franklin Chrysler in Farmington, this is WSKW, Skowhegan, Augusta, Waterville, Legacy 1160.
Whose brother?
ABC News, I'm Tom Rivers. The UK is given the first authorization in the world for a COVID vaccine.
The Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency, or MHRA, in the United Kingdom, granting temporary emergency use authorization to BioNTech and Pfizer. The vaccine will be made available there next week. The companies have also filed for emergency use authorization with the Food and Drug Administration in the U.S. and other regulatory agencies worldwide. Lionel Moise, ABC News.
A panel recommending to the CDC that healthcare workers and then those in long-term care facilities be the first to get COVID shots when they're approved here. Nearly 37,000 people died in the U.S. last month, most since the early days of the pandemic. Department of Justice investigating a possible attempt to pay for a presidential pardon. No names are mentioned in the 18 pages, heavily redacted court documents. This is ABC News. President Trump now demanding Congress roll back protections for social companies like Facebook and Twitter, or else he'll veto the new defense spending bill. New indictments for the captain in a deadly boat disaster off the California coast.
33 passengers and one crew member died in the fire. The NTSB found a number of lapses on board the dive boat, including no night watchman on duty as required by maritime law. Now a federal grand jury indicting Captain Jerry Boylan on 34 counts of seaman's manslaughter. Boylan is expected to turn himself in the coming weeks. If found guilty, he could get 10 years in federal prison for each of the 34 counts. Alex Stone, ABC News, Los Angeles.
And another bank robbery by the two tall bandit. That's what the FBI calls the 6'6" crook, believed to be responsible for 16 robberies since 2009. Most recent, the day after Thanksgiving at a bank in North Carolina. I'm Tom Rivers, ABC News.
At Target, we know a good deal means a great deal. Now save more with Target Circle. This December 5th and 6th, get 10% off Target gift cards with Target Circle. That's 10% off the joy-bringing pocket-sized gift that brings a smile to anyone on your nice list. This Saturday and Sunday only, get 10% off Target gift cards in-store and at Target.com. Save more with Target Circle. Join in the Target app or at Target.com/circle. Terms and conditions apply. Visit Target.com/gift cards for details.
During cough and cold season, Walgreens knows noses, like those noses that tickle and twitch. So cute. And in as little as 30 minutes, Walgreens makes it easy to pick up your cough and cold must-haves. 30-minute pickup. Now that's faster than trying to find a clean sleeve. This week, Walgreens brand cough and cold products now only $9.99. Plus, buy two, get a $3 register reward at checkout. Good on your next purchase. Walgreens. Use as directed. Restrictions apply to 30-minute pickup. Valid through December 5th with my Walgreens. See walgreens.com/pickup for details.
I'm CBS 13's Jeff Peterson with a news update on Legacy 1160 WSKW. Governor Janet Mills says she was likely exposed to COVID-19. In a message on Facebook, she says she's in quarantine. A member of her security detail is considered to be a probable case for the virus. Governor says she has not seen a person since last Saturday. She has no symptoms, but will continue to keep Mainers informed. Governor will take a test tomorrow and remain in quarantine through the 12th.
And the Maine Republican Party is responding in a statement. They say, quote, while we hope that the governor has not contracted the virus, she owes the public and lawmakers more information. They go on to say that due to the timeline, it is possible she and her staff exposed Democratic leadership to the virus, risking spread in the state legislature. State Democrats are also responding. Senate President Troy Jackson says in a statement, quote, once again, the governor is leading by example by quarantining after a public exposure to COVID-19 and putting the health, safety, and well-being of Mainers first. Latest, the CDC numbers show 20 more Mainers have died from the coronavirus. It's important to note that some of the new deaths happened last week and the holidays delayed the most recent numbers. 219 new cases have been reported, and at last check, over 130 people remain hospitalized from the virus. CDC reporting 266 new recoveries. Maine had a record-breaking voter turnout in the November 3rd election. That's the word from Secretary of State Matt Dunlap. Nearly 78% of registered voters cast ballots in the presidential race, either by absentee ballot or in person on Election Day. And to top it all off, there's no record of any COVID-19 outbreak investigations associated with polling places. We have breaking news overnight about Pfizer's coronavirus vaccine. UK has become the first country to approve it for emergency use. This morning, Pfizer's CEO is responding to news, calling the decision a, quote, historic moment. And the United States may not be far behind. The FDA is still considering Pfizer's request here. Today, the Maine State Legislature is convening for the first time since lawmakers adjourned because of the pandemic. Newly elected lawmakers will be sworn in by Acting Chief Justice Andrew Mead at the Augusta Civic Center, where the session was moved for social distancing. Right now, the CDC is planning to change some of its coronavirus guidelines. Two senior administration officials tell CNN the agency is expected to cut down quarantine recommendations from 14 days down to 7 to 10 days after exposure. And Bowdoin College and the Brunswick Hotel are working together to house students to provide each student their own room. College needs some additional housing options. Meanwhile, the hotel has seen fewer guests. According to the college, hotel will provide housing for about 25 students who cannot travel home for winter break. After the break, up to 50 first-year students will live at the hotel for the spring semester. Sports, a lot to talk about. ESPN is reporting tonight Celtics will take on Kevin Durant and Kyrie Irving and the Brooklyn Nets on Christmas night. Tip-off at 5 p.m., part of five games when it comes to the NBA. And this morning, high school students all over Maine will get a chance to take part in a virtual symposium being presented by the Maine Sports Hall of Fame. NESN's Tom Caron will be the moderator. Of course, Tom used to work at CBS 13 as well. At 9 a.m., students will hear from Celtics VP and player development Allison Feaster, along with Red Claws President Dwan Eubanks. At 10 a.m., former University of Maine, Michigan State, and Duke women's basketball coach Joanne Palama-McCallie will be joined by her former player and current UMaine women's basketball coach Amy Vachon. And then at 11 a.m., this year's Division III NCAA Women's Basketball Player of the Year, former Bowdoin grade Maddie Hassett will join former UMaine football star and longtime NFL lineman Mike DeVito. I'm CBS 13's Jeff Peterson on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
The end of the year is bringing with it big savings on new vehicles during the Big Finish sales event going on now at Hike Chrysler Dodge Jeep. Stop in and save now through December 31st. Hike Chrysler Dodge Jeep, 507 Lakewood Road, Clow's Corner, Madison.
Kennebec Eye Care is pleased to let you know that they have reopened for routine eye care with temporary office hours Monday through Thursday from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Fridays from 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. To schedule an appointment, call 872-2797. Kennebec Eye Care will continue to follow all CDC guidelines to make sure everyone stays safe and healthy. Contact lens can still be ordered over the phone and mailed to you, or you can set up a time for curbside pickup of contact lens or glasses. Kennebec Eye Care, your sight specialists at 216 Main Street in Waterville, would like to say thank you to everyone for supporting local businesses.
Interested in cutting your fuel oil bills by as much as 40%? Then call your Energy Kinetic System 2000 premier dealer, Pools Plumbing, Heating, and Air Conditioning, and ask about the System 2000. You can save up to 40% off your heating cost and have all the hot water you need with the System 2000 from Energy Kinetics. Whether you're planning on replacing your current boiler or building a new home, stop into the Pools showroom at 19 North Street in Waterville and see the System 2000 from Energy Kinetics. The System 2000 runs on oil or propane, can be converted between fuels with a simple burner change, is whisper quiet, and can save you up to 40% off your heating fuel cost. If you own an older boiler, help keep it running more efficiently with a cleaning and tune-up. And don't forget, when you need emergency service, call Hool's 24-hour service department at 872-6762. Hool's Plumbing, Heating, and Air Conditioning, your System 2000 premier dealer.
I'm CBS 13 meteorologist Lexi O'Connor. Mostly sunny this morning, but we'll see increasing
Clouds through this afternoon. Chance for a snow shower late afternoon and evening, especially through New Hampshire and hills and mountains. Will be more seasonal with highs in the low 40s today. Mostly sunny, highs in the mid 40s. Tomorrow, clouds return on Friday, and we'll have the chance for some rain and mountain snow Saturday and into Sunday.
Thank you, Lexi. We have sunshine. It's 37 in Skowhegan, 39 in Waterville. Sunshine, 39 degrees as well here in Augusta. And you're up to date from Maine's Heritage Station, Legacy 1160, WSKW.
It's like your father is on the radio every day.
When I was 17, I drank some very good beer. I drank some very good beer I purchased with a fake ID. My name was Brian McKee.
It's the Mike Violet Show on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
Good morning, 7:10, that middle of the weekday that we affectionately refer to as Wednesday. It's December 2nd, 2020. The show brought to you by Kennebec Electric and Lighting, 861-7028. Find them online, kennebecelectric.com. You can find the show online, our live stream at legacy1160.com, powered by the Harry J. Smith Company, and, of course, Facebook as well, my page, John James page, John's Freedom Pep Rally page, American Women Who Bear Arms page. What else? I don't know. Spin the wheel and see. It's brought to you by Moody's Collision Center. It is that middle of the weekday that we call Wednesday. It means it's time for the Ken and Mike Hour. I welcome in my once and now current partner, Mr. Ken Altshuler. Good morning, Ken. Ken?
Man, on this lovely Wednesday morning here in paradise.
Yeah. Freeport has always been considered paradise, Ken.
Well, it could be worse. If we could have snow on the ground, we could, we could be in quarantine for 14 days. Now that we only have to have quarantine for 7 to 10 days, this is good news.
Well, Governor Mills, of course, is in quarantine. Did you hear?
I did hear. She evidently, one of her security staff tested positive, so she's in quarantine.
Yes. So the Republican Party's dream, Governor Mills in quarantine.
You guys.
Come on.
Remember, Mike, it's a process.
That's a private inside joke between me and Ken. But yes, everything, as I say, quoting Sergeant Martens from NYPD Blue, everything is a situation. I guess that's the same as everything is a process.
Yes. That's true. So how do you feel about the vaccinations? I mean, the UK has already started distributing it to its citizens, and we will be pretty soon doing the same. You must feel very good about this.
I think it's fine. I'm not against them, but I find it interesting that we need to have a vaccination for something with north of a 99% survival rate.
But you can't, look, we've had 260,000 deaths so far. They're probably going to be 300 to 350 by the time we're done, maybe more than that. I mean, the worst flu season is 60,000 lives. If this is 5 to 6 to 7 times as many deaths, and the virus, it's not just dying from it, it's also the contagion, how contagious it is. And look, I understand it's been a pain in the butt. It's going to be a year out of our lives. I understand that. But Mike, it could have been much worse without the effort that people like Jenna Mills took. You should be thanking her, Mike. Thanking her.
Are you done?
I want you to send her, Michael, I want you to send her a thank you note this afternoon.
That was the finest piece of rump swabbery that you have performed in quite some time.
Well, thank you so much.
All of this for something with north of a 99% survival rate. We have allowed this to take over our lives. We have allowed this to stop our economy. We have allowed this to completely change and shape our behavior for something with north of a 99% survival rate.
Well, remember, for people over 65, the survival rate is not 99%.
It's still in the upper. 90. It's still up in the upper 90s.
No, it's about 94.
All right, it's in the mid 90s.
I'm in that age range.
So am I.
That 6% death rate is That's a significant death rate.
It is. It is, but we think of it. I mean, we talk about this virtually every week, but we have allowed it to completely change the way we live. We have stopped our children from going to school for the most part. We have stopped our children from participating in athletic or extracurricular activities, even though they statistically, and the numbers say, and of course, the left is always talking about the science of the numbers, that they are impacted by this less than anyone. And anyone under the age of 50 pretty much is going to shrug this off and move on. And yet we're not sending kids to school. We have completely disrupted and ruined the economy. The economy in Maine, this will take decades to recover from. And yet you're telling me that Janet Mills did a great job and I should send her a thank you note.
So let me ask you a question, Mike. What do you think we should have done? You think we should have just done the herd immunity and just open up everything and let everyone get it and let everybody get over it and we'll be okay?
With a 99% survival rate? Yeah.
Well, we don't know what the survival rate would have been if the hospitals had been so filled we had to put people out on deer and oak to be treated. We don't know that. People, in fact, remember the way we were treating people in the beginning wasn't even the right way to treat them. I mean, it took us some time to figure out what the best treatment for them is. And so you would have had the death rate or the survival rate would not have been 99% with herd immunity in the United States of America. And we have more cases that per capita than any other country in the world, except maybe Brazil, I think.
Right. I understand that. But again, the number I look at is the number that is factually correct. And that is a 99% survival rate. And we have completely changed the way we live. Everything we do is different. And I wonder when we're going to change back, if we are going to allow ourselves to change back. And I'm not so sure we are.
Well, some things will never change. I mean, Zoom will become the primary way that we talk to people now. I mean, I tend to think, I mean, I've done maybe 2 in-court hearings and everything else has been by Zoom. I meet some clients in the office, but most clients want to meet by Zoom. So I've been working much more out of my house than I have my office.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, the way we do our lives whether we'll have masks on in 6 months, I don't know. But, you know, remember, I mean, places like Hong Kong and Singapore used to wear masks outside just for the smog. So maybe masks will be part of our lives from now on. Maybe we'll be healthier.
They aren't going to be part of my life. You're not going to be catching me wearing a mask all the time. You literally are going to do that? You're going to submit to that?
Well, first of all, Mike, you know, guys like you and I look better with masks on than with masks not on. So it's really great when nobody knows if I'm laughing or frowning. I mean, I can glare at somebody and nobody has a clue what I'm doing.
Well, I do have to say, where was I yesterday? I was in a store. Oh, I was in Hannaford in Portland. And somebody did something. It doesn't take much to tick me off. And I did mouth F you to them. And of course, they couldn't see me. So that is one benefit. All right, let's move on. Attorney General Bill Barr says, move along now. There's nothing to see here. No widespread election fraud. What gives, Ken?
Well, this is pretty interesting because Barr, who in my opinion is the worst attorney general other than John Mitchell in the history of the United States, who was a rump swab for Donald Trump in his entire tenure. Why he would do this is beyond comprehension to me because whether he's sending a signal to Donald Trump that it's over or has some other plans in mind, I think he's just covering his ass. I think he's trying to kind of salvage whatever legacy he gets when Trump's out of office for future consideration. But it is certainly a bizarre turnaround. It's something that guys like Mitch McConnell should be doing, and it's not the cowards who are in leadership positions in Congress. So I think it's amazing, but it's inexplicable.
Well, Rudy Giuliani said, with all due respect to the attorney general, there hasn't been any semblance of an investigation into any of this. And I actually agree with him, just like the media has ignored all of it. I don't think Bill Barr exactly busted his wide carcass looking into this.
You know how many lawsuits got filed and dismissed because there was not one shred of evidence in any allegation
of fraud. I know that. And I wonder if we've got a judge or a court that's brave enough to actually take a case like this.
But Mike, when you file a pleading in a court to do something, you've got to present to them evidence of what you're claiming. You can't just be Rudy Giuliani and say, hey, you know, I know fraud when I see it because I've committed it many times in the past. And there's fraud all over the place, rampant fraud. That does not work. You have to say, here is the beef. Here is the evidence. There is no evidence. They don't have any evidence. You can't just go on a fishing expedition because Rudy Giuliani claims that Donald Trump couldn't have lost if there wasn't fraud. I mean, that makes no sense.
Yet you live and work in a profession where one of the standard sayings is you can indict a ham sandwich if you want to.
But because that, now let me explain that.
Everything because is a situation, I know.
The reason why you can indict a ham sandwich is because when the district attorney presents an indictment to the grand jury, nobody else is present. You don't hear the other side. So you're absolutely correct. So the district attorney says, here's the evidence we have. We're not going to give you the other side. They'll be able to present that at trial. So the DA presents evidence. Rudy Giuliani is not doing a grand jury. He is saying to the judge, I want you to either stop the count or reverse the count or stay the count or require a new election. And we don't have any evidence to suggest you should do that, but you should do that so maybe we can find something if you do that. That's not how it works.
All right, moving along, Senators Collins and King are part of a bipartisan group of senators who proposed a $900 billion coronavirus relief package yesterday. Part of that package is about $230 billion in forgivable loans through the PPP program. You going back to the well for the PPP program, Ken?
No. And listen.
You and Sarah Gideon's husband?
Money, if I can get free money, listen, I almost said a bad word. I paid a ton of taxes in my life. I have no problem getting some of it back.
So there.
Yeah. So I'm fine with that. How about the fact that Jenna Mills has released funds to help the
hospitality industry. And I had Steve Hewins on from Hospitality Maine yesterday, and we talked about this. My question to him was, is it too little too late? And he said, look, I don't want to look a gift horse in the mouth and no good deed goes unpunished, but this is too little too late. The industry already got killed last June and July, Ken. It's too late.
Yeah, but the industry didn't get killed by Jenna Mills.
Yes, it did. Like,
no, it didn't. Nobody was traveling from anywhere during the summer.
Janet Mills told them not to come here.
What states in the country thrived on tourism last summer? None.
Well,
Vermont did it. New Hampshire did it. Massachusetts did it. Nobody did.
If Massachusetts jumped off a bridge, should we do it too?
Well, I think we should. New England should jump off a bridge simultaneously and support for each other.
It is, you know how quickly, and by the way, it's capped off. You can only get as much as $20,000. So that's nothing. I mean, you know as many people in the hospitality business, whether it's bars, restaurants, hotels, or a combination thereof, $20,000, that doesn't do anything.
Yeah, what we have to do is reopen business.
Right.
So we have to do it in a safe and careful manner. Look, people will bounce back. Next summer, I predict next summer is going to be a banner year for tourism. And a lot of people will recoup their losses. And I think that NBA went out of business. It's tragic. It's unfortunate. You know, but look, the record industry went out of business when they started making CDs instead of LPs. I mean, that happens.
Ken, that's nonsensical. That is apples and manhole covers.
I thought it was a pretty good analogy.
If Ross Perot were here, he'd say something like to the effect of, well, that's like crossing a polecat with a flamingo or something like that.
Look, I understand. I honestly do, because you know I have friends in the industry.
Yeah.
And I'm assuming the Harris-Seeking Inn has really taken a hit. No doubt about it. You know, and I hope it bounces back. And I hope some of the restaurants in Portland will probably go out of business. That's really, really tragic and unfortunate. But we had a disease that could have ran rampant and could have caused tremendous impact on the health of our citizens. And it was a balance. And I understand that the industry did not win that balance, but we did. And that's the way it goes.
Wow, that's the way it goes. Okay, sit tight on that. I'm glad you mentioned restaurants in Portland because I want to get to that topic and the context of the Chamber of Commerce filing a lawsuit yesterday against Hazard Pay. We'll talk to Ken about that, and we'll get to other things with Ken Altshuler. It is the Ken and Mike Hour. We roll on after a real news update, all the main and local news of the morning from CBS 13's Jeff Peterson. And CBS 13 meteorologist Lexi O'Connor will have the forecast. I'm Mike Pilot. It's the Ken and Mike Hour on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
If you've checked the gift list twice, and it's got something different for everyone on it, just head to Town Line Antique Center on the Winslow-Vassalboro Town Line. With two floors and over 50 dealers, you can find the perfect gift for each one of them. Are you worried about spending too much? Town Line Antiques is here to help you with that too. Because all December long, every booth at Town Line Antiques is offering discounts of 10, 20, 30, 40, some even 50% off their selection. There's always new, cool, and unique gift ideas, including collectibles, furniture, artwork, signs, books, and much more. Of course, the problem is, you not only find lots of great gift ideas, you'll come across things that you may want to take home for yourself. But with their December sale of up to 50% off, you can take them all home for less. So don't miss out on this Santa-sized sale with savings up to 50% off this December. At Townline Antiques, open Tuesday through Sunday from 10 to 5. Route 201, right on the Winslow-Vassalboro town line.
Electrical repair should never be done without the knowledge of how to do it safely. Better yet, skip that stress and let Kennebec Electric and Lighting take care of it for you. Kennebec Electric has offered professional electric and lighting service and expert installation in homes and businesses for over 37 years, and they stand behind that experience with a guarantee on all their work. Kennebec Electric and Lighting. Contact them for all your electric and lighting servicing, including installations and repairs, at 861-7028 or online at kennebecelectric.com.
At Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union, they understand that when faced with difficult and challenging times, it's a comfort to know that we'll get through this together. Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union is committed to keeping not only their members safe, but also their dedicated employees. They're following CDC guidelines, protocols, and social distancing at all of their facilities. They may have changed some of their usual ways of doing business, but they haven't changed how they treat their members. Their safest services are available through drive-up, ATM, telephone, easy banking, mobile banking, by phone, or appointment. Lobbies are currently open in the Skowhegan and Farmington branches, and with the holidays just around the corner, Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union has a reason to brighten your season with their holiday loan special going on now through December 31st. Just ask any of their friendly and knowledgeable loan officers in Skowhegan, Farmington, Madison, Kingfield, or Scranton for complete details or online at f-sfcu.com. Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union, where their most important member is you. Member NCUA.
Hi, I'm Teresa Smith, Director of Advising at Kennebec Valley Community College. For the past 25 years, it has been my privilege to help people just like you reach your educational goals. Whether you're a high school student just getting started, a parent who's always had to put your family first, or a worker looking for new skills, KVCC has something for you. And trust me, it's never too late to get started. Give me a call at 453-KVCC, and together, let's see what we can do.
Delta Ambulance is the area's leading provider of high-quality emergency services and medical transportation in Central Maine. You can always rely on Delta for safe transportation for routine or critical care transfers to and from any healthcare facility or home, regardless of distance. Since 1972, Delta Ambulance has been standing by, ready to help when you need it most. Learn more about the difference Delta makes at deltaambulance.org. Compassion, leadership, excellence. That's Delta Ambulance.
I'm CBS 13's Jeff Peterson with a news update on Legacy 1160 WSKW. Governor Janet Mills says she was likely exposed to COVID-19 in a message on Facebook. She says she's in quarantine. A member of her security detail is considered to be a probable case for the virus. Governor says she has not seen a person since last Saturday. She has no symptoms, but will continue to keep Mainers informed. Governor will take a test tomorrow and remain in quarantine through the 12th. And the Maine Republican Party is responding in a statement. They say, quote, while we hope that the governor has not contracted the virus, she owes the public and lawmakers more information. They go on to say that due to the timeline, it is possible she and her staff exposed Democratic leadership to the virus, risking spread in the state legislature. State Democrats are also responding. Senate President Troy Jackson says in a statement, quote, once again, the governor is leading by example by quarantining after a public exposure to COVID-19 and putting the health, safety, and well-being of Mainers first. Latest, the CDC numbers show 20 more Mainers have died from the coronavirus. It's important to note that some of the new deaths happened last week and the holidays delayed the most recent numbers. 219 new cases have been reported, and at last check, over 130 people remain hospitalized from the virus. CDC reporting 266 new recoveries. Maine had a record-breaking voter turnout in the November 3rd election. That's the word from Secretary of State Matt Dunlap. Nearly 78% of registered voters cast ballots in the presidential race, either by absentee ballot or in person on election day. And to top it all off, there's no record of any COVID-19 outbreak investigations associated with polling places. We have breaking news overnight about Pfizer's coronavirus vaccine. UK has become the first country to approve it for emergency use. This morning, Pfizer's CEO is responding to the news, calling the decision a, quote, historic moment. And the United States may not be far behind. The FDA is still considering Pfizer's request here. Today, the Maine State Legislature is convening for the first time since lawmakers adjourned because of the pandemic. Newly elected lawmakers will be sworn in by Acting Chief Justice Andrew Mead at the Augusta Civic Center, where the session was moved for social distancing. Right now, the CDC is planning to change some of its coronavirus guidelines. Two senior administration officials tell CNN the agency is expected to cut down quarantine recommendations from 14 days down to 7 to 10 days after exposure. And Bowdoin College and the Brunswick Hotel are working together to house students to provide each student their own room. The college needs some additional housing options. Meanwhile, the hotel is seeing fewer guests. According to the college, the hotel will provide housing for about 25 students who cannot travel home for winter break. After the break, up to 50 first-year students will live at the hotel for the spring semester. Sports, a lot to talk about. ESPN is reporting tonight Celtics will take on Kevin Durant and Kyrie Irving and the Brooklyn Nets on Christmas night. Tip-off at 5 p.m., part of five games when it comes to the NBA. And this morning, high school students all over Maine will get a chance to take part in a virtual symposium being presented by the Maine Sports Hall of Fame. Nesson's Tom Karen will be the moderator. Of course, Tom used to work at CBS 13 as well. At 9 a.m., students will hear from Celtics VP and player development Allison Feaster, along with Red Claws President Dewan Eubanks. At 10 a.m., former University of Maine, Michigan State, and Duke women's basketball coach Joanne Palama-McCallie will be joined by her former player and current UMaine women's basketball coach, Amy Vachon. And then at 11 a.m., this year's Division III NCAA Women's Basketball Player of the Year, former Bowdoin great Maddie Hassett will join former UMaine football star and longtime NFL lineman Mike DeVito. I'm CBS 13's Jeff Peterson on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
Interested in cutting your fuel oil bills by as much as 40%? Then call your Energy Kinetic System 2000 premier dealer, Pools Plumbing, Heating, and Air Conditioning, and ask about the System 2000. You can save up to 40% off your heating cost and have all the hot water you need with the System 2000 from Energy Kinetics. Whether you're planning on replacing your current boiler or building a new home, stop into the Pools showroom at 19 North Street in Waterville and see the System 2000 from Energy Kinetics. The System 2000 runs on oil or propane, can be converted between fuels with a simple burner change, is whisper quiet, and can save you up to 40% off your heating fuel cost. If you own an older boiler, help keep it running more efficiently with a cleaning and tune-up. And don't forget, when you need emergency service, call Hool's 24-hour service department at 872-6762. Hool's Plumbing, Heating, and Air Conditioning, your System 2000 premier dealer.
If you've checked that gift list twice and it's got something different for everyone on it, just head to Townline Antique Center on the Winslow Vassalboro Town Line. With two floors and over 50 dealers, you can find the perfect gift for each one of them. Are you worried about spending too much? Townline Antiques is here to help with that too, because all December long, every booth at Townline Antiques is offering discounts of 10, 20, 30, 40, and some even 50% off their selection. There's always new, cool, and unique gift ideas, including collectibles, furniture, artwork, signs, books, and so much more. Of course, the problem is you'll not only find lots of great gift ideas, you'll come across things that you might want to take home too. But with their December sale of up to 50% off store-wide, you can take them all home for less. So don't miss out on the Santa size sale with savings up to 50% off this December at Townline Antiques, open Tuesday through Sunday from 10 to 5. Route 201 right on the Winslow-Vassalboro Town Line.
I'm CBS 13 meteorologist Lexi O'Connor. Mostly sunny this morning, but we'll see increasing clouds through this afternoon. Chance for a snow shower late afternoon and evening, especially through New Hampshire and the hills and mountains. We'll be more seasonal with highs in the low 40s today. Mostly sunny, highs in the mid-40s. Tomorrow, clouds return on Friday, and we'll have the chance for some rain and mountain snow Saturday and into Sunday.
Sun's out, 37 in Skowhegan, 39 in Waterville. Sun, 39 in Augusta. You're up to date from Maine's Heritage Station, Legacy 1160 WSKW.
In a state where common sense is a lost art, he's basically your father.
Didn't crawl out from under no rocks. We didn't have no tails. We didn't come from monkeys. You atheistic pink on me.
It's the Mike Vilas Show on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
Damn straight, it is 7:35. Good morning. Welcome, Mike Vilas Show in progress on this middle of the weekday that we call Wednesday. It's December 2nd, 2020. The show brought to you by Kennebec Electric and Lighting, 861-7028. Find them online, kennebecelectric.com. Live stream us 24-7, 365. Legacy1160.com is where you go for that. Click on the Listen Live button. Sponsored by the Harry J. Smith Company. Facebook Live, all over the place on the Legacy page, my page, John's page, and more, brought to you by Moody's Collision Center. It is Wednesday, that middle of the weekday that we call Wednesday, which means we're talking to Ken Altshuler. It is the Ken and Mike Hour. And of course, as a resident of the People's Republic of Portland, Ken, I had the distinct pleasure of voting no on many of the referendum questions that were on the ballot, including that voter-approved measure. Many people voted opposite for me to require a minimum wage of $18 an hour hazard pay during declared emergencies. And so the Portland Chamber of Commerce yesterday filed a lawsuit saying that this is unconstitutional. It violates the Maine Constitution, violates the city ordinances. We'll get into your legal expertise on that in a second. But what happened to the will of the voters? As bad as I think this stuff is, Ken, the people want it. So why shouldn't they get it?
Well, this highlights what you and I have both been saying since we first met. If we're going to have the voters decide the laws, why do we need a city council? Why do we need a legislature? Let's just abandon both of them.
Yep.
And let's just put every issue before the voters and let them decide what they want to do.
Yeah, I'm for that.
And the reason we don't do that is because the average voter is an idiot, which is why we don't do that.
Right.
Okay? So the problem is not that the voters pass this. It's that we allow voters to put forward legislation because they feel good about it and it seems like to be a really nice thing to do. And that's why we should not have people's referendums on the state or the city level ever for any reason, period.
Well, I love that.
And so, that's it in a nutshell. I mean, because you're talking about feel-good legislation. I mean, you know, why don't we have minimum wage $50 an hour? I don't know why we're stopping at 15. Let's just go to 50.
You sound like a cold, angry, bitter conservative there.
No, because, look, I'm an economic realist. I mean, I am a capitalist. I like money. I make no apologies for it. I may disagree with how we spend the money that we get in taxes, but I don't like to pay taxes. And I think that we waste a whole lot of tax money.
Oh, no doubt.
But you know, look, I pay my staff far more than $15 an hour, you know? But that's not what the minimum wage was intended to be for. It was intended to stop slave labor and little kids working 13 hours a day in the coal mine for a penny an hour. That's the whole use of minimum wage. A living wage does not. You're not going to survive.
Yeah, again, if you think you are, you're stupid. But
exactly.
Here's my point, though. The citizens of Portland voted in favor of this 62%, 62 to 38. That's a pretty big margin. Wasn't even close. So shouldn't they get the, whatever you want to call them, unintended consequences? This is what they wanted. And I know the business community, for the most part, is against it. But shouldn't they now suffer the consequences of their vote and have this go into effect? Maybe it'll start to teach them a lesson.
Well, but see, I don't think it'll teach them a lesson. I mean, if you look at cities like Seattle that does bizarre, crazy things, they haven't reversed what they've been doing.
So
they have people going out of business. Oh, well, that's tough luck. That's the way it goes in the big time, you know. So, your point is well taken. You get what you deserve. You want to do that, go right ahead. Don't complain to me when it backfires on you. I agree with that. That's a valid point. And I think that, but what it should do is precipitate a move to eliminate people's referendum. I mean, I'm not adverse to a people's veto. I think there's some sense in saying, look, if the legislature passes a law that you really think is horrible and you can get everybody to agree with you on it, you know, with some, I would increase the number of signatures required. I may make it more difficult, but I get the veto. I don't get legislation by the people because that's where representative government, you hire people to make these decisions for you. If you don't like the decisions they make, vote them out of office.
Yep.
If you don't have a chutzpah to do that, that's your problem. And that's the way we should do representative government. But your point is well taken. I don't live in Portland. I live in Freeport. And I don't think you're going to see that happening in Freeport.
So let's look at this from the legal standpoint. The chamber saying that this whole thing violates the Maine Constitution and the city ordinances. What insight can you give us there?
I don't agree. I don't see how it violates the Constitution. I don't see anything in the Constitution that says that, that towns can't set a minimum wage, and therefore, why can't they set a hazard pay? Their argument that a people's referendum cannot include this kind of provision may be a better argument, but I'm not so sure why it can't. I mean, I think if you have a people's referendum and you can get sufficient signatures to put it on, I don't think it's illegal. I think it's stupid, but I don't think it's illegal. I'm not really confident that legislation is going to work.
Yeah, I don't think so either. I mean, look, I don't know anything about the law, but go ahead and file the suit. But I think it's much ado about nothing, and I think they're going to end up losing.
On the state level, I mean, keep in mind that people's referendums on the state level, there are provisions that allow the legislature to modify it or, frankly, not implement it if they really didn't want to do it. For example, the tip credit legislation that got passed, which was really stupid legislation that was going to drive a lot of restaurants out of business because they can't pay their wait staff minimum wage, and, you know, they get tips to compensate them. So, I mean, if you remember, the legislature re-implemented the tip credit so that restaurants didn't have to pay their wait staff minimum wage. So there is provisions in the state legislature, in the state laws that allow the legislature to modify stupid legislation brought by people. But I don't think Portland has that.
I don't think they do either. That's Ken Altshuler. It's the Ken and Mike Hour here on Legacy 1160 WSKW. So we are going to have a new Secretary of State, and I was surprised to see that it's going to be Shanna Bellows. She was
and
able.
Why were you surprised?
I just and for no other reason that I the other people involved, like Justin Chenette, and let's see who else, Matt Moonen, and Craig Hickman, they were all politicking for it. So I really thought that one of them had a chance to win it, but I was shocked that Shanna Bellows won. She will, of course, be the first female Secretary of State in the history of the state. But I was just surprised, given the field as big as it was, that she was able to get through the political backslapping that needs to be done in order to win.
Well, so this shows why when people say, why would Shanna Bellows run against Susan Collins when she knows she's going to get slaughtered and she's not going to win? Why would she do this? This is exactly why people do this, because the payback of sacrificing yourself is that when you want to be Secretary of State, people say, she sacrificed herself. Let's give this to her.
Let's give her the $118,000 hack job.
Well, I don't know why she wants the job. It's an issue. $118,000
is not bad money to make, Ken.
No, I don't know. I'm not sure what Shanna was doing other than being in the legislature. I don't know what she was doing for her career. Was she, you know what she was doing?
She was running some like Holocaust thing or something. I think. Of course, she used to
That's not going to be a high paying.
No, and you know, she used to be head of the ACLU of Maine. We know that, but yeah, I don't. And when Ethan became mayor in Portland, she took over at whatever the place was. Was it Living Works, Life Works?
Learning Center.
Learning, yeah, whatever it was. She took over there for a while. So, yeah, I mean, this obviously is a big bump in pay. But I love all of the inside baseball, including now Matt Dunlap sliding over, running unopposed for state auditor, even though he's not qualified to be state auditor. And shockingly, there's nobody running against him, Ken.
And I got to say, you and I talked about this last week. You know, you don't become a CPA overnight. No. You don't become a CPA in 9 months either. I mean, that CPA, that's a rigorous education and examination. And the law allows you to do that in 9 months. Good luck with that. I mean, I don't know how you become a CPA in 9 months. I think it takes a little longer than that. So, you know, I hesitate to say that is a wise decision for Matt to make. And I really like Matt, and I think he was a great Secretary of State. But Secretary of State and State Auditor are very different jobs.
Yeah.
And that's a little bizarre. I'm not sure why he's doing that or why they're letting him do it.
Well, I know why they're doing it, because they can and because they are rewarding him. They're keeping him employed.
Yeah, and look, I know that Republicans hate lifetime employees. Of course, Susan Collins got elected for a fifth term, so you guys don't mind that.
Well, yeah, crazy. But that's not cronyism to the point that this is.
Well, I agree. I'm not sure it should be. I'm not sure whether it's an elected position.
And I'm not sitting here all high and mighty saying that Republicans don't do this either, because they do.
Right. Yeah. I mean, look, there are lifetime bureaucrats and lifetime politicians. And I think if they do a good job, I mean, I think Matt Dunlap did a good job as Secretary of State, and I had no problem with him serving three terms, but I'm not so sure I'd support him as a state auditor. In fact, I wouldn't. I like him, but I don't think he's qualified.
Yeah. Oh, well. All right. You must be, as somebody who is incredibly concerned about climate change and global warming, you must have been heartened to hear Governor Mills unveil her 4-year climate action plan yesterday.
Yeah.
Hey, Ken, 30,000 clean energy jobs by 2030.
You know, look, I do believe that climate issues are extremely important issues. I do think that. And I think that, you know, we should be cognizant and aware of that. And I think Donald Trump certainly set back on a national level a lot of the safeguards that we need to be put in place. Although, once again, I think it's a balance. And I think you got to balance between, you know, business and economy and what, you know, it's kind of like the CMP corridor. I mean, that's a really good example. Yeah, it's going through some pristine areas of the state, but pristine areas of the state that nobody ever looks at. And so the balance on there, it seems that the CMP corridor makes more sense from business perspective than it does from an environmental perspective.
Yeah.
But you got to have a balance there. And so sometimes, but I don't think, look, I don't think Janet Mills' proposals are going to, I mean, I haven't gotten down in the weeds, but I don't think it's going to bankrupt the state. I don't think we're talking about a huge financial investment that's going to, because we're not going to be able to afford any kind of huge financial investment for a very long time based upon the effects of coronavirus.
Well, that's just, that was another point I was going to make. I mean, here in the midst of, you know, this economic pandemic, if you want to call it that, because of the pandemic, you know, I mean, really seriously, is anybody thinking about, wow, you know, we need a climate change initiative here. We really do. I don't understand it. The thinking of it is nonsensical to me.
Yeah, I think it's an issue that's got to be on the agenda, but I think right now we have other priorities. I mean, I think the two priorities are coronavirus and the economy. Those are the two most critical issues. And I'm not saying we should forget all other issues, but those are the ones that are going to should be taking our attention and our money. And that's where we should be focusing on. I think those two issues are critical, particularly, I mean, once everybody gets and I know everybody's going to get the vaccination. I don't, you know, you'll be first in line, right?
Yeah.
So So once everybody gets vaccinated and we get back to normal, let's say March and April, we're going to have a devastated economy that we're going to have to take care of. And I think that's going to be a priority. That's why we put the money. I think those, you know, the, I don't want to call them bailouts, but certainly the hospitality industry, we're going to need to pump in a lot of money to shore it up. We're going to have to do that if we want to save Maine's economy.
Did you and the rest of the Doyle Altshuler clan live within the stringent restrictions of Governor Mills over the Thanksgiving holiday?
Yes. My wife and I, my two children, my son-in-law, and my two grandchildren had Thanksgiving dinner together. That was it.
Okay. Nobody else entered the house?
Nobody entered the house. We were invited to friends of ours in Harpswell for a Thanksgiving dinner of about 8 to 10 people. We declined the invitation.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're responsible, law-abiding citizens.
You were dutiful little citizens doing exactly as you were told. That's just what they want.
I never smoked pot until it was legal. Not one moment of my life did I smoke pot before it was legal.
Well, I mean, as an officer of the court,
I
certainly understand you taking that stand and being having the restraint, the personal restraint that it must take in order not to do that until such an old age. Amazing.
Well, I will admit that one time I didn't inhale it and I didn't like it, but I did try it. And as I said, when Bill Clinton said that, I said, I've inhaled it many times and I've liked it a lot. So
I did not have sexual relations with that woman, Miss Lewinsky.
You can always believe what Bill Clinton has to say.
You know, speaking of Bill Clinton, you know, I was looking at pardons, presidential pardons,
mm-hmm.
and because, you know, Donald Trump is going to pardon his family and himself and Rudy Giuliani. And by the way, there's an investigation going on a pay-for-pardon little scheme here.
What's wrong with that? It's a little pay-for-pardon, a little P-for-P.
Exactly. But, you know, I mean, Bill Clinton, I forget that guy, Rich. Well, I forget his first name.
Yes.
Who was
Mark Rich, wasn't it?
Mark Rich, which was just a horrible, horrible pardon. I suppose I should have expected it from Bill Clinton because I don't think he has any moral fiber. But that was a really bad pardon.
Absolutely. Really, really bad. So as we close things down here, I love to poke the bear known as Ken Altshuler, and I did so over the weekend because your beloved Michigan Wolverines did it again. They lost to Penn State in football. Everybody beats Penn State except for the Michigan Wolverines. And there was a story yesterday from Clay Travis on Outkick.com where Harbaugh was talking to the media yesterday on a Zoom presentation and talking about trusting the process. How long has this process been going on there with Jim Harbaugh again?
Got hired in 2014.
Okay.
he has not been in Ohio State. He's been 3-3 with Michigan State.
Mm-hmm.
He's 2-12 with top 10 teams. And I think he's a little better with ranked teams up to 25. He's lost 4 bowl games. I think he's doing pretty good.
Yeah. Trust the process.
Yeah. And I love Jim Harbaugh. And I thought the hire of Jim Harbaugh was going to bring Michigan back to prominence.
Yeah.
6 years. You've had a lot of recruiting classes. It's time for Jim Harbaugh to go. And I don't know who they'd hire to replace him. But, you know, I mean, we've had just a series. I mean, Brady Hoke. And then you have these Ohio State coaches. I mean, my God, you bring in the assistant coach to be coaching. They beat Michigan. I mean, they get these great top 5 teams every freaking year.
Maybe there's a message there. Maybe Michigan needs to bring in an Ohio State man.
Well, remember, Bo Schembechler was.
I know.
Ohio State.
Yes, so, yeah. And then Bo, of course, turned around and would only hire Michigan men. You remember Steve, what's his name?
I do.
All right, Ken, thanks for the time, as always. Another special Ken and Mike Hour. We'll see you for That's a Wrap on Friday.
Thanks, talk to you then, pal.
All right, take care. Ken Altshuler. 7:53. Agree to disagree. Pinch hitting this morning for Ethan Strimling, Betsy Sweet. Going womano a mano against Phil Harriman. That's coming up at 8:08. It's 7:53. I'm Mike Violet. This is the Mike Violet Show. Legacy 1160, WSKW.
At Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union, they understand that when faced with difficult and challenging times, it's a comfort to know that we'll get through this together. Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union is committed to keeping not only their members safe, but also their dedicated employees. They are following CDC guidelines, protocols, and social distancing at all of their facilities. They may have changed some of their usual ways of doing business, but they haven't changed how they treat their members. Their safest services are available through drive-up, ATM, telephone, easy banking, mobile banking, by phone, or appointment. Lobbies are currently open in the Skowhegan and Farmington branches, and with the holidays just around the corner, Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union has a reason to brighten your season with their holiday loan special going on now through December 31st. Just ask any of their friendly and knowledgeable loan officers in Skowhegan, Farmington, Madison, Kingfield, or Stratton for complete details, or online at f-sfcu.com. Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union, where their most important member is you. Member NCUA.
The end of the year is bringing with it big savings on new vehicles during the Big Finish sales event going on now at Hike Chrysler Dodge Jeep. Stop in and save now through December 31st. Hike Chrysler Dodge Jeep, 507 Lakewood Road, Clowes Corner, Madison.
Hi, it's Doug and Dan from Generators of Maine in Belgrade.
Are you working from home? Will your children be home doing schoolwork? And you know how important it is to have access to the reliable power source.
That's why you need a Kohler generator from Generators of Maine. Kohler generators deliver reliable power whenever yours goes out. And we're always happy to offer delivery and installation.
Get prepared today for those upcoming power outages with a Kohler generator from Generators of Maine. Stop by our location in Belgrade. Visit online at generatorsofmaine.com and like us on Facebook.
Electrical repair should never be done without the knowledge of how to do it safely. Better yet, skip that stress and let Kennebec Electric and Lighting take care of it for you. Kennebec Electric has offered professional electric and lighting service and expert installation in homes and businesses for over 37 years, and they stand behind that experience with a guarantee on all their work. Kennebec Electric and Lighting. Contact them for all your electric and lighting servicing, including installations and repairs, at 861-7028 or online at kennebecelectric.com.
I'm a hiker, and I am Sam.
The Sportsman's Alliance of Maine is a champion of our rights to fully enjoy Maine as we like. Support the preservation of our proud outdoor heritage by becoming a member at sportsmansallianceofmaine.org today.
Hi, my name is Tony Esposito from Rockland Ford. This year has been crazy, and this month, so are our deals. Ford has finally started making cars again, so our lot is full and the incentives are high. This month only, you can buy a brand new redesigned Ford Escape for as low as $22,415 or $359 a month with no money down. I repeat, you can buy a brand new Ford Escape at Rockland Ford for as low as $359 a month with no money down. And if a truck is what you need, we got you covered. Rockland Ford just made a special purchase of 35 low-mileage program F-150s. As low as $23,995 or only $359 a month with no money down. This month only, buy a brand new Escape or program F-150 for $359 a month with no money down. Call us while supplies last at Rockland Ford, home of the Rock Bottom Deal, Route 1 in Thomaston.
Payments are for qualified credit for 84 months at 4.5% APR.
Hi, I'm Jeff from K-Tronics. K-Tronics is proud to be the local entertainment expert of Somerset, Franklin, and Piscataquis counties for 23 years and counting. Come visit us today for a hands-on demonstration of the Hopper Whole Home DVR from Dish and learn all the tips and tricks to make entertainment easy. When you shop with K-Tronics, not only will you get best-in-class customer service, you'll also be supporting your local community. Call 207-696-3200 or visit us today at 57 Main Street in Madison.
Delta Ambulance is the area's leading provider of high-quality emergency services and medical transportation in Central Maine. You can always rely on Delta for safe transportation for routine or critical care transfers to and from any healthcare facility or home, regardless of distance. Since 1972, Delta Ambulance has been standing by, ready to help when you need it most. Learn more about the difference Delta makes at deltaambulance.org. Compassion, leadership, excellence. That's Delta Ambulance.
7:58, agree to disagree with Bill Harriman and pinch hitter Betsy's suite for Ethan Strimling this morning. We'll hit with the boy and the girl on Governor Mills being quarantined, the constitutional officers election or elections yesterday, the bipartisan coronavirus package that's coming from the Senate. The Biden cabinet, A.G. Barr, says no shenanigans. And a whole lot more with Bill Harriman and Betsy Sweet in for Ethan Strimling. Agree to disagree is coming up next. After, though, we get a world to national news update from ABC News, Maine and local news, real news from CBS 13's Jeff Peterson and CBS 13 meteorologist Lexi O'Connor with a forecast. It's all ahead on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
From the Home Auto Group studios, Farmington Ford and Franklin Chrysler in Farmington. This is WSKW, Skowhegan, Augusta, Waterville, Legacy 1160.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming. Hail the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
ABC News, I'm Faith Abube. The British government says yes to one of the COVID vaccines, the official announcement this morning at 10 Downing Street.
The Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency has this week recommended to the UK government, on the basis of the advice of the Commission on Human Medicines, that it should agree to the approval for use of the COVID-19 vaccine developed by Pfizer-BioNTech.
Dr. June Rain, head of medicines and healthcare products at the regulatory agency in Great Britain. Nearly 37,000 people died of COVID during the month of November, the most since the early days of the pandemic. States have begun reopening field hospitals and some have implemented tough new restrictions. Senate Republicans looking to pass a scaled-down version of the COVID-19 relief bill during the lame duck session and then taking the issue up again next year when Joe Biden is president. Talks resumed on Capitol Hill this week. This is ABC News. Arizona Senator-elect Mark Kelly will be sworn in on Capitol Hill later on this afternoon. He gets to be sworn in now since he won a special election to fill the rest of the late Senator John McCain's term. The captain of a dive boat that caught fire and sank last year off the California coast, killing 34 people, now indicted on 34 counts of manslaughter. One of the top election officials in Georgia blasting some of his fellow Republicans for the attacks, claiming his state's election was rigged. Gabriel Sterling says the rhetoric from the president and Georgia's two Republican Senate candidates is leading to threats.
Mr. President, you have not condemned these actions or this language. Senators, you have not condemned this language or these actions. This has to stop. We need you to step up. And if you're going to take a position of leadership, show some.
President Trump in a tweet responded by saying, quote, expose the massive voter fraud in Georgia. Faith Abube, ABC News.
At Target, we know a good deal means a great deal. Now save more with Target Circle. This December 5th and 6th, get 10% off Target gift cards with Target Circle. That's 10% off the joy-bringing pocket-sized gift that brings a smile to anyone on your nice list. This Saturday and Sunday only, get 10% off Target gift cards in-store and at Target.com. Save more with Target Circle. Join in the Target app or at Target.com/circle. Terms and conditions apply. Visit Target.com/gift cards for details.
Indeed Ideas.
So I want to add a screening question that'll help me in the whole hiring process. Something specific to the company, like the team you'll be joining is currently working on this project. How do you see yourself helping out? Yeah, that'll help me gauge their readiness to jump in and if they'd be a good fit for the team.
If you need to hire, you need Indeed. You instantly get a list of quality candidates from Indeed's resume database the moment you sponsor a job. Get started at Indeed.com/credit.
I'm CBS 13's Jeff Peterson with a news update on Legacy 1160 WSKW. Governor Janet Mills says she was likely exposed to COVID-19. In a message on Facebook, she says she's in quarantine. A member of her security detail is considered to be a probable case for the virus. Governor says she has not seen a person since last Saturday. She has no symptoms, but will continue to keep Mainers informed. Governor will take a test tomorrow and remain in quarantine through the 12th. And the Maine Republican Party is responding in a statement that says, quote, while we hope that the governor has not contracted the virus, she owes the public and lawmakers more information. They go on to say that due to the timeline, it is possible she and her staff exposed Democratic leadership to the virus, risking spread in the state legislature. State Democrats are also responding. Senate President Troy Jackson says in a statement, quote, once again, the governor is leading by example by quarantining after a public exposure to COVID-19 and putting the health, safety, and well-being of Mainers first. Latest, the CDC numbers show 20 more Mainers have died from the coronavirus. It's important to note that some of the new deaths happened last week and the holidays delayed the most recent numbers. 219 new cases have been reported, and at last check, over 130 people remain hospitalized from the virus. CDC reporting 266 new recoveries. Maine had a record-breaking voter turnout in the November 3rd election. That's the word from Secretary of State Matt Dunlap. Nearly 78% of registered voters cast ballots in the presidential race, either by absentee ballot or in person on election day. And to top it all off, there's no record of any COVID-19 outbreak investigations associated with polling places. We have breaking news overnight about Pfizer's coronavirus vaccine. UK has become the first country to approve it for emergency use. This morning, Pfizer's CEO is responding to the news, calling the decision a, quote, historic moment. And the United States may not be far behind. The FDA is still considering Pfizer's request here. Today, the Maine State Legislature is convening for the first time since lawmakers adjourned because of the pandemic. Newly elected lawmakers will be sworn in by Acting Chief Justice Andrew Mead at the Augusta Civic Center, where the session was moved for social distancing. Right now, the CDC is planning to change some of its coronavirus guidelines. Two senior administration officials tell CNN the agency is expected to cut down quarantine recommendations from 14 days down to 7 to 10 days after exposure. And Bowdoin College and the Brunswick Hotel are working together to house students to provide each student their own room. The college needs some additional housing options. Meanwhile, the hotel has seen fewer guests. According to the college, the hotel will provide housing for about 25 students who cannot travel home for winter break. After the break, up to 50 first-year students will live at the hotel for the spring semester. Sports, a lot to talk about. ESPN is reporting tonight Celtics will take on Kevin Durant and Kyrie Irving and the Brooklyn Nets on Christmas night. Tip-off at 5 p.m., part of five games when it comes to the NBA. And this morning, high school students all over Maine will get a chance to take part in a virtual symposium being presented by the Maine Sports Hall of Fame. Nesson's Tom Karen will be the moderator. Of course, Tom used to work at CBS 13 as well. At 9 a.m., students will hear from Celtics VP and player development Allison Feaster, along with Red Claws President Dewan Eubanks. At 10 a.m., former University of Maine, Michigan State, and Duke women's basketball coach Joanne Palama-McCallie will be joined by her former player and current UMaine women's basketball coach, Amy Vachon. And then at 11 a.m., this year's Division III NCAA Women's Basketball Player of the Year, former Bowdoin great Maddie Hassett will join former UMaine football star and longtime NFL lineman Mike DeVito. I'm CBS 13's Jeff Peterson on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
Hi, I'm Teresa Smith, Director of Advising at Kennebec Valley Community College. For the past 25 years, it has been my privilege to help people just like you reach your educational goals. Whether you're a high school student just getting started, a parent who's always had to put your family first, or a worker looking for new skills, KVCC has something for you. And trust me, it's never too late to get started. Give me a call at 453-KVCC, and together, let's see what we can do.
Sales and service by a family who cares. Whittemore & Sons, Whittemore & Sons.
There are some things you can simply never depend on, like getting your morning coffee just the way you like it every day.
I mean, you order it the same way. How is it different today? But know that you can always count on Whittemore & Sons in our line of Coyote tractors. Coyote tractors are machines made to work, whether it's mowing, tilling, digging, lifting, or hauling. Check out the full line of tough and versatile Coyote tractors, attachments, implements, and accessories at Whittemore & Sons, your Coyote tractor dealer, with dependable sales and service for over 50 years. Run ahead of the pack with a Coyote tractor from Whittemore & Sons on the Waterville Road in Skowhegan. Sales and service by a family who cares.
From work to fun, we'll help you get it done. Whittemore & Sons. Outdoor power equipment.
I'm CBS 13 meteorologist Lexi O'Connor. Mostly sunny this morning, but we'll see increasing clouds through this afternoon. Chance for a snow shower late afternoon and evening, especially through New Hampshire and the hills and mountains. We'll be more seasonal with highs in the low 40s today. Mostly sunny, highs in the mid 40s. Tomorrow, clouds return on Friday, and we'll have the chance for some rain and mountain snow Saturday and into Sunday.
Thank you, Lexi. Sun's out nice and bright out there. 37 in Skowhegan, 39 in Waterville, sunshine 39 as well in Augusta. And you're up to date from Maine's Heritage Station, Legacy 1160 WSKW.
You think it? He says it.
Yada, yada, yada.
It's the Mike Violet Show on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
Yes, indeed, it is 8:09, that middle of the weekday that we call Wednesday. It is December 2nd. 2020. The Mike Violet Show is brought to you by Kennebec Electric and Lighting, 861-7028. Online at kennebecelectric.com.
There's fire and ice, oil and water, black and white, Republican and Democrat. Phil Harriman and Ethan Strimling will agree to disagree. Thank you very much. It's Agree to Disagree on the Mike Violet Show on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
Okay, in this corner, we have the usual Phil Harriman. He's on the right side of things. And in this corner, pinch hitting for Ethan Strimling, who traditionally is on the wrong side of things. Today, filling in, it's Betsy Sweet. First of all, Betsy Sweet, good morning and welcome to Agree to Disagree.
Well, thanks so much for having me. Hi, Mike. Hi, Phil.
Good morning, Betsy. You've amped up the class on this broadcast.
Yeah. I'm out of my league.
So the question I have for you right off, Betsy, is do you want to be fire or do you want to be ice?
Oh, fire. Absolutely.
Okay. All right. So fire it is. So, all right. Now, one thing that we do here, we always ask our contestants who are playing the game, that's you and Phil, you must respect the bell. So when you hear the bell, that means it's time to move on. So we're going to start with item number one. That's always the best place to start. And that is that Governor Janet Mills has quarantined after possible COVID-19 exposure. Phil, from the Republican side of things, is this a dream come true?
Well, I wouldn't call it a dream. I just think she's one of the few Democrat governors or mayors around the country who's walking the walk and talking the talk. She has been advocating for the distancing and masking and washing hands and avoid people if you can. And she's been exposed, presumably, from one of her private security detail. Mm. And she's taking the action that she's asked citizens to take, and good for her.
Are you on board with the way things have gone as far as Governor Mills handling this, Betsy?
Absolutely. I think she's done an incredible job. And I think not only is she doing the right thing, she's kind of role model for us that we should all be doing, right? This thing is out of control, you know, and my next door neighbors have it. And, mm-hmm. you know, they're not going to go to the hospital probably, but, you know, I dropped off some turkey soup the other day and my neighbor said, I would never wish this on anybody. So the fact that this has become a political football is just, it's absurd to me that, you know, we're talking about science, we're talking about people feeling good, and that anyone could think that this was a good thing for somebody else. It's really, I mean, it's baffling.
Well,
how public health issue got to be a political thing.
You haven't had the pleasure of having this discussion with me as of yet. So let's have that discussion right now, talking about science and numbers. And okay. I'm not exactly a scientist and I'm not exactly a math major either. I'm just an idiot talk show host, but you want to talk about numbers. The survival rate for this, Betsy, is north of 99%. That's a pretty significant number.
Oh, yeah. No, absolutely. The survival rate is good, but there's also over 250,000 people dead. And they're saying that there's going to be way more than that by the end of the year. And that's just, in 29 days or whatever. So I think, I don't think it's about survival, but we're looking at what we're doing to people in how many people are hospitalized and what's it doing to essential workers. And so it's not really just life or death. It's also serious illness. And so it's like, you know, it doesn't make sense when we have things that are so easy to do. It doesn't make sense that people say, oh, we don't care about that. I mean, this is like the number of people dying is the equivalent of 5 jumbo jets going down full of passengers every day.
Yeah,
now, if that was happening,
I get that. Crazy. But, you know, there are 3 million people that are going to die in this country this year because of obesity. I mean, we could
I think we should be doing public health about obesity, too.
Yeah, we should. If we cared more about that, maybe those people wouldn't be so COVID susceptible. Yeah. But anyway, let's move on. You could not swing a dead cat in Augusta without hitting someone who wanted to be on the Democrat side, the Secretary of State. I think, Betsy, you were the only one that I know of from the Democrat side who didn't have his or her hat in the ring. And the last woman standing was the last woman standing. Shenna Bellows is going to be, unless something wacky happens between now and the end of the day, she's going to be the new Secretary of State. I was surprised, not because Shenna's not up to the job, but just there were so many inside baseball Democrats there. How did you feel about this, Betsy?
Yeah, I mean, well, she's the last woman standing and the first woman in the job. So yeah, that is something I think that we can all be pretty excited about. You know, I think that, that inside baseball is exactly what it is. You know, I think we need to move to Secretary of State being a statewide election. But I think when you're elected by your colleagues, there's all kinds of things that play into it. And so, you know, it took several rounds to get there. So there was no clear front runner. Yeah. And to start with. So, you know, congratulations to Shenna. I think she'll do an incredible job. I think she'll be a great Secretary of State. But I think people were a little surprised that that's how it ended up.
Phil, were you surprised Bellows survived here?
Yeah, I am. There was, as Betsy indicated, there was a lot of people who would earn their standing or gravitas within the Democrat Party that gave everyone reason to think it could have been any one of them. But Shenna, who, as we all know, is passionate about public service. She's run for the U.S. Senate seat. She served in the Maine Senate. She's not shy about stepping forward to run for more political opportunities, and this is actually probably the best place for her to be. She can be seen and heard, and not necessarily in a partisan way. It's a statewide exposure. This is going to be great for her political aspirations. And as Betsy said, she will be the first woman Secretary of State here in Maine, and good for her and good for us.
Yeah, good for that. And Shenna's a friend of the show. I have had her on many times. She's always a thoughtful, albeit disagreeable guest with me, which is more than fine. I certainly appreciate the spirit that she brings. I was just surprised, Betsy, because Shenna's kind of subtle. She's kind of, you know, she runs below the weeds, or, you know, the other people were all kind of loud. Justin Chenette and Craig Hickman, they were all politicking for it. I didn't even know Shenna was in the race until I saw a story in the newspaper about it.
Yeah, well, she, you know, it's what she does. And it's what I think effective legislators do. She talks to people. So she doesn't need to be grandstanding. She doesn't need to be out there, you know, always grabbing the headlines. But she's talking to people one-on-one. That's why she's such a great state senator. She's my state senator, actually.
Oh, really?
And she talks to people. She listens to what they need. She gets things done, you know, behind the scenes. She just wants to get the work done. And I think when, you know, if we had more people in politics who wanted to just get the work done and not care about who got the credit, I think we'd get a hell of a lot more done.
Well, Betsy, let me ask you this. The seat's going to be open. You going to run? Huh? Come on now. How about a Mike Violent Show exclusive?
You're not the first person who has asked.
Yeah.
I do not think so. I and you know why? I'd love to serve, but I can't live on $15,000.
No, I know.
So, you know, and I wish I could. I'm a single mom, 3 kids. I can't do it.
Hey, if I can do it, you can, Betsy. No, I'm kidding. All right. Speaking of big, big money, Senator Susan Collins, Senator Angus King, part of that bipartisan group of senators, calling for a $900 billion, that's with a B, COVID relief package to states and businesses and the unemployed. Is it enough, Phil Harriman? And my second question is, should there be a direct payment to all American people as well? So let's start off with, is it enough?
I don't know the answer to that. I think we have to make a very careful distinction between those in these individual states who have truly been harmed by the executive orders and edicts that have come out from the government that has affected business owners as well as their employees. We have not all been in this together. And I think that's the distinction I'd like to see in this package, regardless of whether it's 900 billion or trillions. And to me, it's about, is the money going to the people who truly need it, or do they fit some general category? And in that category, there'll be winners and losers who pick up more government money that they don't need at the expense of someone at the other end of the matrix who didn't get it because the money ran out or they didn't meet some qualification. And the other thing I'm going to be looking for, Michael, is, you know, some of these states have been spending money they don't have for a long time, and they're going to use this as an opportunity for the federal government and the taxpayers here in Maine to bail out their bad public policies from years or even decades ago.
All right, so I'll get to the direct payment with you in a second. Betsy, let's swing over to you. First question about it being enough. Is it enough, more, less, whatever?
Well, you know, I don't know. Again, I'm like Phil, I don't know that it's enough, but we have got to do something. I mean, people are starving. I mean, if you look at the lines, if we look at the food lines, you know, and the difference between now and in the 20s is that where people are in cars now instead of standing on the street. But there are so many people that are really hurting, and I talk to them every day and see them. And so I'm with Phil. I want the money to be targeted to people. I don't want the Ritz-Carlton Hotel that has huge money to be getting money. And, you know, I think that we have to really be watchful of who gets the money. But I think absolutely we need to do it. States need it. There's no way. States have lost so much revenue. And, you know, I work really hard on the side of people who need mental health services, people who need, you know, health services. And there's just not the money there. It just doesn't exist.
All right. So
we absolutely need help.
So that's a natural segue into a direct payment. Earlier this year, we all got a $1,200 payment. I have advocated all along that all of this other foolishness is not necessary. Make a direct payment to average everyday Americans and leave it at that. Phil, is that crazy or good policy?
No, I think it's good policy. To me, let's get the dollars into the checkbook of the people who Betsy describes, who are either food insecure or worried about when they're going to get evicted or can't put fuel in their heating tanks. And that's where the money needs to go. That's where the relief is needed. And if we can put it in directly into someone's individual checkbook, that is a good direct support to people who can make a difference as we come out of this pandemic.
Betsy?
We all agree. Oh, my God. I 100% think that that's where the money needs to go.
Wow.
And I actually think it's really related to the first question you asked about Janet and the mask issue, which is the reason people are so mad about the restrictions, especially, I think, the extra mad, is because they're not making money and they can't go to their jobs or they can't do, you know, what they need to do. And so if they had money coming in and they could count on it, then they could relax and they could actually quarantine when they're sick or when they're exposed, you know? So I think it creates a lot of, answers a lot of problems.
Okay, let's move on. Let's go back to national politics. And I always, Betsy, just for your information, refer to Joe Biden as the man who the mainstream media says won the election, because I'm not convinced he did. But that's another conspiracy theory for another time. Let's talk about his cabinet so far, the people he has selected so far. He said yesterday that help is on the way. Hang on. Okay. But he also said the cabinet was going to look like America looks. Is that a good thing, Betsy Sweet?
I think that's a great thing. And, you know, the thing that really defines this cabinet so far is that the people who he's appointing, and I don't love all of them, let me tell you, I don't love all of them, but the people that he's appointing believe in the mission of their agency. They believe in the work that needs to be done. And they have some skill and background that they bring to it. And I think that's a huge change. And I think in terms of diversity, that has to be a top priority, because, you know, when you're not at the table, you're usually on the menu. And so we got to make sure that everyone and all corners of America are at the table.
So rather than qualifications, you're looking for diversity.
No. It's not an either or, Mike. Come on. You know, we have plenty of lots and lots of qualified people who before have gotten overlooked because of who they are, and they have incredible qualifications. And so now we're looking for both.
All right, Phil, the Biden cabinet so far, good, bad, ugly, all of the above, or what?
Oh, I think it is a great look at a class reunion. The alumni is coming back together. They're going to pick up where the Obama administration left off, and they're going to reinstitute the policies and programs that they were so passionate about in 2016. And that's presumably, if that's the way the electors decide the outcome of the election, that's the direction we're going to go in. And that's going to make a lot of people, particularly those who are thriving off of the role of government, very content. And those who feel like there's way too much government and too much regulation are going to feel like, oh boy, we're taking a step backwards. But that's, you know, when they say elections have consequences, this is a perfect example.
Yeah, I have to agree with you, Phil. Listening to Janet Yellen yesterday, who's the Secretary Treasury nominee, it sounded like she had been the nominee for the Secretary of Social Justice Warrioring rather than being the Treasury Secretary. But we'll leave that there. Lastly this morning,
yeah, you will.
I'm going to throw this at you first, Betsy, because you're in for Ethan, and this is one of his pet things. The Portland Chamber of Commerce yesterday is they filed a lawsuit to stop the hazard pay provision. And Ken and I were talking about this last hour, even though I think this kind of legislation is loony, lefty loony, but it's expected reliable behavior from the People's Republic of Portland. I think it's about time that the people of Portland start to suffer the consequences of their ill-advised votes. So I think the chamber should just let this thing go. I'll bet you agree, Betsy Sweet.
Well, I think voters have spoken, right? And so I think that, you know, and I think that the opposition comes from a number of places. Some is from businesses like many people in the chamber who have opposed the minimum wage increase since it was $4 an hour. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, this is not surprising behavior. I think the other thing, the hazard pay, which I think everybody believes that people who are, you know, have to go to work and the people who have, you know, slogged it out for all of us at the grocery store and
well,
in the hospital.
Betsy, I'm going to stop you right there.
What?
I'm eligible for hazard pay in that case, in the context of which you just mentioned it. Me, an idiot talk show host on the radio, is eligible. I should not be eligible for hazard pay.
But you could do your work from home.
I could, I suppose so.
Yeah, so then you're not, then you wouldn't qualify. So, you know, so I think, you know, and I think that the problem is for a lot of, I'm worried about the nonprofits, because a lot of them who want to pay their people hazard pay because they're doing the job when everybody else is quarantining at home, they just don't have the money because they're not being reimbursed by the state or the feds by, you know, enough to do this. So I think, you know, I think that, listen, the reason there are all these referendums was because the city council wouldn't listen. It's the same reason we have them on a statewide
but
level.
The same people elected them to the city council, Betsy.
I know, but then they get there and something crazy happens.
Well, then
them.
Vote them out of office and get somebody in there who supports the things that you support. I hate referendum process. Phil, let's quickly swing it over to you. Are you behind this lawsuit by the Portland Chamber of Commerce?
I am, but for different reasons than Betsy's opposition to it, and that is that the ordinance that was written by the advocates of this referendum left ambiguities or confusions or a lack of clarity, and I think that's what the chamber's trying to do, is to stop this from going into effect until a judge can rule on the interpretation of the ordinance that clearly was not clear.
I agree. And lastly, Phil Harriman, you guys, even without Ethan, are you penning a column this week for the Bangor Daily News?
Yes, we are. We actually, it has already been submitted. Today is swearing in day for the new legislature and the constitutional officers, as we talked about this morning. So our article is about what should legislators be thinking about as they raise their right hand and take the oath of office.
How about neutering the power of the governor to start things off? How about that,
one thing is sure, they're all going to get sworn at.
Yes.
Yeah, they're swearing in, they're all going to get
sworn at.
That's
one of the lines we use. Swearing in is at 11 o'clock and swearing at is at about 11:30.
It goes with the territory. Betsy Sweet, fabulous job pinch hitting for Ethan Strimling this morning. You actually made Phil have to use all of his brain instead of about an eighth of it.
Good to talk to you, Betsy.
Thanks, Betsy. We'll talk to you again down the line. Thank you, Phil. Thank you, Betsy.
Thanks, Mike. Thanks.
Agree to Disagree with Phil Harriman and Ethan Strimling can also be seen every week in the Bangor Daily News and on BangorDailyNews.com.
Focus on the White House. Attorney General William Barr spent 2.5 hours at the Executive Mansion Tuesday. Earlier, he told the Associated Press there's no evidence of widespread election fraud.
He specifically shot down one of the president's most explosive claims, that voting machines were manipulated to help Joe Biden win, saying simply, "We haven't seen anything to substantiate that." This is especially significant because Barr has been among the president's most steadfast defenders.
ABC's Jonathan Carl. With the last pandemic relief measures expiring at the end of the month, a bipartisan group of senators is pushing a $900 billion proposal. Majority Leader Mitch McConnell countered with a $500 billion measure, similar to the one that failed earlier.
The reality is that the two sides still remain far apart on the details. This compromise bill, for instance, would not include another round of stimulus checks.
ABC's Mary Bruce. This against a government shutdown set for next week, Friday. Richard Cantu, ABC News.
At Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union, they understand that when faced with difficult and challenging times, it's a comfort to know that we'll get through this together. Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union is committed to keeping not only their members safe, but also their dedicated employees. They are following CDC guidelines, protocols, and social distancing at all of their facilities. They may have changed some of their usual ways of doing business, but they haven't changed how they treat their members. Their safest services are available through drive-up, ATM, telephone, easy banking, mobile banking, by phone, or appointment. Lobbies are currently open in the Skowhegan and Farmington branches, and with the holidays just around the corner, Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union has a reason to brighten your season with their holiday loan special going on now through December 31st. Just ask any of their friendly and knowledgeable loan officers in Skowhegan, Farmington, Madison, Kingfield, or Scranton for complete details, or online at f-sfcu.com. Franklin Somerset Federal Credit Union, where their most important member is you. Member NCUA.
Interested in cutting your fuel oil bills by as much as 40%? Then call your Energy Kinetic System 2000 premier dealer, Pools Plumbing, Heating, and Air Conditioning, and ask about the System 2000. You can save up to 40% off your heating cost and have all the hot water you need with the System 2000 from Energy Kinetics. Whether you're planning on replacing your current boiler or building a new home, stop into the Hool showroom at 19 North Street in Waterville and see the System 2000 from Energy Kinetics. The System 2000 runs on oil or propane, can be converted between fuels with a simple burner change, is whisper quiet, and can save you up to 40% off your heating fuel cost. If you own an older boiler, help keep it running more efficiently with a cleaning and tune-up. And don't forget, when you need emergency service, call Hool's 24-hour service department at 872-6762. Hool's Plumbing, Heating, and Air Conditioning, your System 2000 premier dealer.
I'm CBS 13's Jeff Peterson with a news update on Legacy 1160 WSKW. Governor Janet Mills says she was likely exposed to COVID-19. In a message on Facebook, she says she's in quarantine. A member of her security detail is considered to be a probable case for the virus. Governor says she has not seen a person since last Saturday. She has no symptoms, but will continue to keep Mainers informed. Governor will take a test tomorrow and remain in quarantine through the 12th. And the Maine Republican Party is responding in a statement that said, quote, while we hope that the governor has not contracted the virus, she owes the public and lawmakers more information. They go on to say that due to the timeline, it is possible she and her staff exposed Democratic leadership to the virus, risking spread in the state legislature. State Democrats are also responding. Senate President Troy Jackson says in a statement, quote, once again, the governor is leading by example by quarantining after a public exposure to COVID-19 and putting the health, safety, and well-being of Mainers first. Latest, the CDC numbers show 20 more Mainers have died from the coronavirus. It's important to note that some of the new deaths happened last week and the holidays delayed the most recent numbers. 219 new cases have been reported, and at last check, over 130 people remain hospitalized from the virus. CDC reporting 266 new recoveries. Maine had a record-breaking voter turnout in the November 3rd election. That's the word from Secretary of State Matt Dunlap. Nearly 78% of registered voters cast ballots in the presidential race, either by absentee ballot or in person on election day. And to top it all off, there's no record of any COVID-19 outbreak investigations associated with polling places. We have breaking news overnight about Pfizer's coronavirus vaccine. UK has become the first country to approve it for emergency use. This morning, Pfizer's CEO is responding to the news, calling the decision a, quote, historic moment. And the United States may not be far behind. The FDA is still considering Pfizer's request here. Today, the Maine State Legislature is convening for the first time since lawmakers adjourned because of the pandemic. Newly elected lawmakers will be sworn in by Acting Chief Justice Andrew Mead at the Augusta Civic Center, where the session was moved for social distancing. Right now, the CDC is planning to change some of its coronavirus guidelines. Two senior administration officials tell CNN the agency is expected to cut down quarantine recommendations from 14 days down to 7 to 10 days after exposure. And Bowdoin College and the Brunswick Hotel are working together to house students to provide each student their own room. College needs some additional housing options. Meanwhile, the hotel has seen fewer guests. According to the college, hotel will provide housing for about 25 students who cannot travel home for winter break. After the break, up to 50 first-year students will live at the hotel for the spring semester. Sports, a lot to talk about. ESPN is reporting tonight Celtics will take on Kevin Durant and Kyrie Irving and the Brooklyn Nets on Christmas night. Tip-off at 5 p.m., part of five games when it comes to the NBA. And this morning, high school students, Oliver Mann, will get a chance to take part in a virtual symposium being presented by the Maine Sports Hall of Fame. Nesson's Tom Karen will be the moderator. Of course, Tom used to work at CBS 13 as well. At 9 a.m., students will hear from Celtics VP and player development Allison Feaster, along with Red Claws President Dewan Eubanks. At 10 a.m., former University of Maine, Michigan State, and Duke women's basketball coach Joanne Palama-McCallie will be joined by her former player and current UMaine women's basketball coach Amy Vachon. And then at 11 a.m., this year's Division III NCAA Women's Basketball Player of the Year, former Bowdoin great Maddie Hassett will join former UMaine football star and longtime NFL lineman Mike DeVito. I'm CBS 13's Jeff Peterson on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
If you've checked that gift list twice and it's got something different for everyone on it, just head to Townline Antique Center on the Winslow-Vassaburo Town Line. With two floors and over 50 dealers, you can find the perfect gift for each one of them. Wait, are you worried about spending too much? Townline Antiques is here to help with that too, because all December long, every booth at Townline Antiques is offering discounts of 10, 20, 30, 40, some are even 50% off their entire selection. And there's always new, cool, and unique gift ideas, including collectibles, furniture, artwork, signs, books, and so much more. Of course, the problem is, I not only find lots of great gift ideas, I always come across things I want too. But with their December sale of up to 50% off store-wide, we can take them all home for less. So don't miss out on this Santa-sized sale with savings of up to 50% off this December at Townline Antique Center, open Tuesday through Sunday from 10 to 5, Route 201, right on the Winslow-Vassaburo Town Line.
Sales and service by a family who cares. Widmore & Sons, Widmore & Sons.
There are some things you can simply never depend on, like getting your office printer to work on the first try. Another paper jam? Come on! But know that you can always count on Whittemore & Sons and our line of Coyote tractors. Coyote tractors are machines made to work, whether it's mowing, tilling, digging, lifting, or hauling. Check out the full line of tough and versatile Coyote tractors, attachments, implements, and accessories at Whittemore & Sons, your Coyote tractor dealer, with dependable sales and service for over 50 years. Run ahead of the pack with a Coyote tractor from Whittemore & Sons on the Waterville Road in Skowhegan. Sales and service by a family who cares.
From work to fun, we'll help you get it done. Whittemore & Sons. Outdoor power equipment.
I'm CBS 13 meteorologist Lexi O'Connor. Mostly sunny this morning, but we'll see increasing clouds through this afternoon. Chance for a snow shower late afternoon and evening, especially through New Hampshire and the hills and mountains. We'll be more seasonal with highs in the low 40s today. Mostly sunny, highs in the mid 40s. Tomorrow, clouds return on Friday, and we'll have the chance for some rain and mountain snow Saturday and into Sunday.
Thank you, Lexi. Nice morning out there. 37 sunshine in Skowhegan, sunny 38 in Waterville, sunny 38 degrees in Augusta. You're up to date from Legacy 1160 WSKW.
His mediocre high school academic achievements have prepared him nicely for a career in radio.
Fat, drunk, and stupid is no way to go through life, son.
It's the Mike Violet Show on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
Good morning. It's 8:36. I'm Mike Violet, the Mike Violet Show, brought to you by Kennebec Electric and Lighting, 861-7028 online, kennebecelectric.com. Live stream the show anytime you want to, legacy1160.com. It's powered by the Harry J. Smith Company. We're on Facebook Live as well. Interviews or the segments with Ken. The Ken and Mike Hour and Agree to Disagree with Phil Harriman and Betsy Sweet. They'll be up on the Facebook page right after the show. Always interesting to get another perspective and hear it from the lips of someone other than Ethan Strimling or Ken. But you can hear in Betsy Sweet, the expected reliable behavior that you've come to find to be expected reliable. Complicit, compliant, do whatever they say.
Thank you, sir. May I have
an yes, just like that. From the left. Yep, absolutely. From the left. We've come to know it and love it. Governor Mills has saved our lives, saved our rear ends. All right. The legislature is going to be in session today at the Augusta Civic Center. Governor Mills won't be there, of course, but the acting Chief Justice of the Maine State Supreme Court, Andrew Mead, will deliver the oath of offices. So there's an emergency order that's been put in or going to be put in by State Representative Peter Lyford, Republican from Eddington. He has proposed a joint resolution to the new presiding officers, Democrats, Speaker of the House, and the President of the Senate. The resolution removes the governor's emergency order and provides the legislature with an immediate opportunity to work with the governor and the public to shape policies that are fair for everyone. We've had dictatorship-type ruling through all of this by best using the best evidence-based science and data available. This can be done in December, Representative Lyford writes, rather than waiting for January. Since May, legislative Republicans have called for the legislature to convene for the express purpose of addressing COVID-related emergency measures. These public appeals for a bipartisan approach have been ignored by the Democrats. Jeff Timberlake, the Senate Republican leader, time has run out, is running out for the people whose lives and livelihoods are being destroyed by the response to the pandemic. There's no reason why we can't link public safety efforts to sound science so that things don't get even worse for Maine people. Kathleen Dillingham, the House Republican leader, said this is about giving the people of Maine an avenue to be heard. Representative Lyford is asking that the legislature reestablish the co-equal branches of government under the Maine Constitution and provide a real opportunity for dialogue and bipartisan involvement. This work can be done now, before Christmas, with public input and the work of the legislative committees. Don't count on it. Sounds good. Looks good on paper. Looks good in a PDF file. Doubtful that it's ever going to happen. The Democrats are in control. Elections have consequences. And our consequence is to suffer the consequences of Democrats. You don't think that there's one Democrat in this state with the ability to think for themselves, do you? And go against the grain? And go against the governor? It is not going to happen. Because apparently, Democrats don't own small businesses. Democrats don't have to make payrolls. Democrats don't own a business in the hospitality industry. They're not going to go against their governor. So Representative Lyford's idea, proposal, sounds good, and that's about it. Don't expect much to happen there. Okay. As bad as it is here, and it's bad when it comes to the COVID and our overreaction by Mills and everybody else in the state, virtually everybody else in the state, you know, with a select few, you know, Nick Isgrove, mayor of Waterville, Jason Levesque, mayor of Auburn, but generally it's been a whole bunch of social justice warrioring. Well, you know, Gavin Newsom out in California is the king of social justice warrioring and overreacting to the pandemic and California in general. So out there in Santa Clara County, in the aftermath of the numbers spiking up of COVID-19, San Francisco and San Mateo counties rolled out restrictions very similar to what Santa Clara did as far as being able to partake in athletic activities. There are new COVID-19 regulations that include a temporary ban on all high school, collegiate, and athletic sports. So And professional sports, I should say. So, athletic sports. All sports are pretty much athletic. Golf, not athletic. Anyway, another topic for another time. So, the San Francisco 49ers, who play at Levi Stadium, which is in Santa Clara County. It's not in San Francisco. Cannot play football. They can't practice. They cannot play their game. Stanford University, the Cardinal, singular, the color, cannot practice. They cannot play football. Tom Brady's alma mater in high school football, I think it's San Rafael High School, can't play. So, what do you do if you're the San Francisco 49ers? Well, you play your Week 13 and Week 14 home games against Buffalo and the Washington football team in Arizona, where the Cardinals play at State Farm Stadium, because the Cardinals, those Cardinals, not to be confused with the Stanford Cardinal, happen to be out of town those 2 days, thankfully enough. This is insanity. Now, the San Francisco, we aren't going to have a bake sale or a bottle drive for the San Francisco 49ers. Nor will we have to for anyone that owns an NFL team. It is a license to print money. However, this is just, have I mentioned that we're living in the stupidest times ever? This is just insanity. And once again, for the umpteenth million time, elections have consequences. You have to be very careful of the people that you put in power. Now, people like Betsy Sweet, they love this stuff. They think it's fantastic. I don't. Ken loves this stuff for the most part. I don't. You probably don't either. This is beyond crazy. I played the J.P. Sears bit earlier this morning. It's just stupid how compliant we have become. Whatever they say, we're willing to do. Doesn't matter. It just doesn't matter. We have given up our liberties and freedoms. This is shown me a lot, this whole COVID-19 thing, about how easily swayed we are. It's almost like we are looking for someone to grab our life by the horns and run it for us. I mean, I could make an ex-wife crack here and get away with it, but I mean, there are always people in your life, if you let them, who are looking to run your life. Most of them now are politicians that we have put in power. And we've got to start being much more careful. This is a broken record. I beat it all the time. But we have just given in. We have just given up. Sure. What liberty would you like to take now, Madam Governor or Mr. Governor, Madam Mayor or Ms. Mayor? You know, I see Shanna Bellows talking about being the Secretary of State, if I could find the damn story here. Where'd it go? I don't know. And again, I talked earlier about Janet Yellen, the Secretary of Treasury nominee, you know, talking yesterday about social justice warrior stuff, about racial inequality. Yesterday, Bellows talking about how all of the candidates for Secretary of State agree on the need for progressive voting system changes, including paying for postage for absentee ballots, instituting an online voter registration option, and automatically sending absentee ballots to voters who request them. I mean, this is, again, you know, activist, social justice warrioring stuff. I can't wait to have Shanna on and ask her. My first question is, do you support non-citizens being allowed to vote in our elections? The Secretary of the Treasury nominee yesterday, all about social justice, not about Treasury economy stuff, but about how to balance it all out and how to make it equality, make it equal. And I'm just not sure that's the job. But if the man the mainstream media says won the election ends up winning the election, especially as easily as this guy's going to be pushed around. I mean, you know, they literally are spoon feeding this guy oatmeal. The leftist agenda, the one reason, well, there's more than a one, but one of the reasons, aside from Trump being able to do what he's done to the Supreme Court, which has been magnificent, but Donald Trump was, you know, the vanguard. He was the last bastion of defense between this crazy leftism and giving up of our rights everywhere and the left. And boy, we're, you know, I don't care where you look at it. And I've talked this morning about the Chamber of Commerce in Portland suing about this hazard pay thing. And I'm seriously at the point where the businesses of Portland have to suffer the repercussions. Yes, it's going to crush business. Yes, it sucks for business. But this is what your customers want. And I hate the referendum process. Ken and I have already gone through that. I would whack it. Absolutely no doubt about it. You heard Betsy Sweet talking about, I know I'm all over the place here, ranting and raving. Well, the city council won't. Well, they were elected by the same freaking people who vote. Maine voters are stupid. Portland voters are stupider. We're just all over the place. They elect the city council and the mayor. They throw Strimling, who loves all this stuff, out of office, finishes third in a three-horse race. They throw him out of office. Then what do? They embrace every policy idea that he has. He could not, he said it himself here, he could not have handpicked the results of the municipal election in Portland better himself than they came out. So they throw him out of office. They put someone in Kate Schneider, who's a nut, but not as big a nut as Strimling is, but she's not nutty enough for the progressive Portland people. And now the chamber, of course, takes this to court. And, you know, that's what they're supposed to do, is protect their members. But the people voted for the 62% to 38%. So you got to watch who you vote for. And it's almost rendered me absolutely speechless. The Maine Center for Economic Policy, not to be confused with the Maine Heritage Policy Center. One's, clear and sensible. The Maine Center for Economic Policy is a far left-leaning research group. They have said that as many as 23,500 Portland workers could see a wage increase under the new ordinance, with 14,000 workers now making less than $15 an hour. But you know what? That's what the people who buy your products, it's such a quandary. But then again, it isn't. Maybe it's just time to take your beating. And the beatings will end when morale improves. I so love this sound effect.
Thank you, sir. May I have another? Thank you, sir. May I have another? Thank you, sir. May I have another?
I just don't know what it's going to take for people to dummy up. And it's not just Portland. We make fun of Portland. I do all the time. The People's Republic of. It's so easy to do. But this is what they voted for. And I, you know, like I said, I think I'm half on board with this lawsuit and half hoping that it gets thrown out of court. And I don't want people to lose their businesses, but it's probably going to happen. I mean, it's already happened. Governor Mills has already, with her heavy-handedness, been singularly responsible for what I would dare say are hundreds of businesses going out of business. You can't have a drink after 9 o'clock in a bar. Oh, until December 6th. And then December 7th, you can have a drink after 9 o'clock in a bar. I'll wear your mask while you're walking in the restaurant, but when you sit down in the restaurant, you don't need to wear your mask. This is also freaking stupid. Have I mentioned we're living in the stupidest times ever? Have I? May have done that. It makes my head hurt. I'm going to have to take ibuprofen after the show. It's 8:54. I'm Mike Violet. Come back and tell you what's coming up next. Coming up next on Legacy 1160 WSKW.
I'm CBS 13's Jeff Peterson with a news update on Legacy 1160 WSKW. Governor Janet Mills.
Interested in cutting your fuel oil bills by as much as 40%? Then call your Energy Kinetic System 2000 premier dealer, Kuhl's Plumbing, Heating, and Air Conditioning, and ask about the System 2000. You can save up to 40% off your heating cost and have all the hot water you need with the System 2000 from Energy Kinetics. Whether you're planning on replacing your current boiler or building a new home, stop into the Kuhl's showroom at 19 North Street in Waterville and see the System 2000 from Energy Kinetics. The System 2000 runs on oil or propane, can be converted between fuels with a simple burner change, is whisper quiet, and can save you up to 40% off your heating fuel cost. If you own an older boiler, help keep it running more efficiently with a cleaning and tune-up. And don't forget, when you need emergency service, call Hool's 24-hour service department at 872-6762. Hool's Plumbing, Heating, and Air Conditioning, your System 2000 premier dealer.
ABC Entertainment News.
Comedy, commentary, and squirrels top YouTube's list of top trending videos for 2020.
Thank you all for coming.
Coming in first was Dave Chappelle's poignant 8:46.
This man kneeled on a man's neck.
In which he took to the stage not so much for comedy, but to get real about the death of George Floyd and the protests that followed. Mark Rober's squirrel obstacle course came in second.
So the first challenge is the bridge of instability.
With Saturday Night Live's presidential debate spoof in third.
Boring.
Stranger Things star Millie Bobby Brown in tears over an encounter with a fan who took video of her shopping after the actress asked her not to.
And I said, no, no, when I said no. It just makes me upset when people try to push the boundary.
She posted that on Instagram. The Crown star Helena Bonham Carter says she agrees the show should have a warning label telling viewers it's not entirely accurate. And oops, she did it again. Britney Spears is 39 today. Jason Nathanson, ABC News. Hollywood.
Kennebec Eye Care is pleased to let you know that they have reopened for routine eye care with temporary office hours Monday through Thursday from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Fridays from 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. To schedule an appointment, call 872-2797. Kennebec Eye Care will continue to follow all CDC guidelines to make sure everyone stays safe and healthy. Contact lens can still be ordered over the phone and mailed to you, or you can set up a time for curbside pickup of contact lens or glasses. Kennebec Eye Care, your sight specialists at 216 Main Street in Waterville. Would like to say thank you to everyone for supporting local businesses.
Delta Ambulance is the area's leading provider of high-quality emergency services and medical transportation in Central Maine. You can always rely on Delta for safe transportation for routine or critical care transfers to and from any healthcare facility or home, regardless of distance. Since 1972, Delta Ambulance has been standing by, ready to help when you need it most. Learn more about the difference Delta makes at deltaambulance.org. Compassion, leadership, excellence. That's Delta Ambulance.
Hi, I'm Teresa Smith, Director of Advising at Kennebec Valley Community College. For the past 25 years, it has been my privilege to help people just like you reach your educational goals. Whether you're a high school student just getting started, a parent who's always had to put your family first, or a worker looking for new skills, KVCC has something for you. And trust me, it's never too late to get started. Give me a call at 453-KVCC, and together, let's see what we can do.
Hi, my name is Tony Esposito from Rockland Ford. This year has been crazy, and this month, so are our deals. Ford has finally started making cars again, so our lot is full and the incentives are high. This month only, you can buy a brand new redesigned Ford Escape for as low as $22,415 or $359 a month with no money down. I repeat, you can buy a brand new Ford Escape at Rockland Ford for as low as $359 a month with no money down. And if a truck is what you need, we got you covered. Rockland Ford just made a special purchase of 35 low-mileage program F-150s, as low as $23,995 or only $359 a month with no money down. This month only, buy a brand new Escape or program F-150 for $359 a month with no money down. Call us while supplies last at Rockland Ford, home of the Rock Bottom Deal, Route 1 in Thomaston.
Payments are for qualified credit for 84 months at 4.5% APR.
8:58. I know we're living in the stupidest times ever, but one good thing, if you want to look on the positive side of things, to come from the COVID, Wednesday afternoon NFL action. Yeah, the Baltimore Ravens, in a game that was supposed to have been played Thanksgiving night, are going to be in Pittsburgh playing the undefeated Steelers this afternoon. Without Lamar Jackson, by the way, RG3 will start today for Baltimore. 3:40 is your game time. So Dr. Phil, well, it's going to be on NBC. I don't know what's on NBC at 3 o'clock on Channel 6 or Channel 2. Is Days of Our Lives still on? So the sands of the hourglass will not be like the Days of Our Lives. I am so old. But yeah, NFL football this afternoon. 3:40 is game time on NBC. I don't hate it. I absolutely don't hate it. I think actually it's pretty doggone cool that we're going to have some afternoon football with no fans in the stands, which is as dumb as it gets. John James is up next. Freedom Pep Rally. It's time. From 9 until noon, as we continue 6 hours of live local talk on the only place you're going to find it on the radio in Maine, right here, Legacy 1160 WSKW, legacy1160.com. I am done. I'll see you back here bright and early tomorrow morning at 6.
From the Home Auto Group studios, Farmington Ford and Franklin Chrysler in Farmington. This is WSKW, Skowhegan, Augusta, Waterville, Legacy 1160.
ABC News, I'm Faith Abube. The British equivalent of the FDA has given the go-ahead for the vaccine developed by Pfizer and BioNTech. Its approval for use is for those 16 years of age and older. The CDC making an adjustment to its quarantine recommendation for people who've been exposed to COVID. Less time in quarantine is now the rule.
What the CDC is basically saying is, hey, if you are exposed to someone who has coronavirus or you think you were exposed, 7 days with a negative test is probably enough for you to end your quarantine. If you can't get a test, make it 10 days.
ABC News medical contributor, Dr. Alok Patel. President-elect Joe Biden will today participate in a virtual roundtable with workers and small business owners hit hard by the pandemic economic crisis. Newly unsealed court documents show the Justice Department is now looking into allegations that lobbyists may have tried to bribe White House officials, offering money in exchange for presidential pardons. No government officials were being investigated. This is ABC News. As coronavirus cases mount across the country, the stress on healthcare workers also climbing.
An El Paso nurse describes watching terminally ill COVID patients FaceTime with their families.
There's nothing you can say that is going to make it better.
A survey by the nonprofit Mental Health America finds that 9 in 10 healthcare workers feel like she does. And what's more,
82% were experiencing emotional exhaustion, a much greater percentage than the number who were even feeling physical exhaustion.
MHA President Paul Gianfrido says the lasting impact of COVID-19 may be an exodus of healthcare workers from the profession, unless they're provided mental health counseling, along with face shields and gloves. Jim Ryan, ABC News.
A big step for an Oscar nominee, actor Elliot Page announcing on Instagram that he's a transgender person. The actor, formerly known as Ellen Page, says his joy at making the announcement is mixed.